All right, hi, good afternoon. I want to welcome everyone to this afternoon's event, Youth and Their Money, New Insights into the Financial Lives of Youth in Developing Countries. So when we embarked on YouthSave, a consortium initiative of Save the Children, the Center for Social Development at Washington University in St. Louis, the Global Assets Project here at the New America Foundation, and the Consultative Group to Assist the Poor, CGAP, back in 2010, precious little was known about youth and their financial lives, their resources, their preferences, and their behaviors. I think we had a sense, obviously, that this very vulnerable population was in kind of all too often ignored market. And, you know, we thought if we can get the products and services right, then this, you know, population could make up a potentially lucrative and eventually stable market, for financial institutions, while also kind of kickstarting a road to financial independence and empowerment for the youth themselves. So that was 2 years ago. 2 years later, we are today, and the members of this consortium are coming together to release several papers. This you see outside a long table full of papers. I think that from our team alone, we have maybe seven coming out today in all that kind of are expanding on this new understanding of youth, from access to preferences and behaviors, and the implications that this understanding has not only for our work, but for the entire youth financial services field. And, you know, recognizing that we are not alone in this field by any sort of imagination, we're very pleased that some of the preeminent experts on youth financial services, youth livelihoods, financial capability, and behavioral economics are joining us at this event today to contribute to the dialogue, sharing their experiences, their ideas, and their opinions. One of those experts is Ruth Dueck-Mbeba of the MasterCard Foundation, and she's going to kick us off with some opening remarks, after which we'll move directly into two quick panels. Understanding demand is the first, and nudging behavior the second, before some closing remarks on shifting perspectives on the potential opportunities of the youth financial services market by Alexia Latortu of CGAP. Each panel should have enough time for plenty of Q&A from the audience. And if you're watching over our webcast, and all of our events are webcast live, and or otherwise want to join the discussion online, you can follow some live tweeting that will be happening during the event using the hashtag YouthSave. So we're not going to be taking any breaks during the panels. I just want to give this logistical information up front. But we do promise to reward everyone's patience during the shifting and moving and shaking that we're going to be doing with drinks after the two panels, starting at 5 p.m., drink some food. So stick around and we'll try to make it worth your while. Sorry for those who are watching online. So without further ado, I'd like to introduce Ruth to everyone. Ruth Dueck-Mbeba from the MasterCard Foundation has over 30 years' experience in accounting and financial management, and as a practitioner, trainer, and consultant in the field of microfinance, operating in many regions of the world, particularly sub-Saharan Africa. She's currently a microfinance program officer with MasterCard Foundation. She worked for MITA for 25 years and previously served as a SEEP Financial Services Working Group facilitator. She has extensive experience in building capacity at all levels of organizations and in the design and delivery of microfinance curriculum in the areas of financial management, risk management, internal controls, and internal audits. So Ruth, please come on up. Thank you.
Thank you. Good afternoon. And welcome to YouthSave Youth and Their Money event. I'd like to begin by thanking the YouthSave Consortium for inviting me to speak. It's a pleasure to be here with you today. And thank you to all of those who are participating by webinar. To set the stage, I'd like to begin with a bit of a personal reflection. I've been privileged to share much of my life with a chosen son who has been a source of energy, joy, and also personal growth in my life, making a mother out of me in the process. A number of years ago, I reached a significant birthday in my life, and he turned to me and said, "Well, Mama, the world belongs to me now. You've had your turn." He was only 14 at the time and already wiser beyond his years. And I often think about what he said, particularly in preparation for today's event. Because looking at the sheer numbers of young people in the world today, the world does indeed belong to youth. They're currently close to, 1.5 billion people between the ages of 12 and 24, close to 80% of them living in developing countries. These young people are a force in their own right and have a legitimate voice at the table. But the world that they live in is much more complex today than ever before. And for those who are poor, there are far fewer opportunities than ever before. At this point, there's roughly 81 million unemployed youth. And in developing countries, most of them lack access to education, employment, and financial opportunities. Their frustrations are palpable. We see them in the news and on our television screens. But at the same time, their energies and ambitions for successful transitions are also palpable. And this is why much of the MasterCard's Foundation's focus is on young people in developing countries, particularly in the African continent. The foundation was established in 2006 through the generosity of MasterCard Worldwide when it became a public company at that time. The foundation operates independently. Our vision is a world in where opportunities are there for all to learn and to prosper. So we have two basic program areas, the first one being youth learning and the second being microfinance. Most of the focus is around young people. We really believe that it's a combination of skills building, education, employment, entrepreneurship, and access to financial services that can support people, but particularly young people, who live in the poorest parts of the world to create their own opportunities, build self-reliance, and become change agents in their local communities. So what are the young people looking for? The young people that we are meeting through our programs are usually earning and learning. They are looking for opportunities that will enable them to continue that learning path, but also have opportunities to earn more and, yes, to save more. They're looking for flexibility, for choices, for options. But too often they are isolated and excluded from the economic arena. But their stories capture a really powerful picture of the need and the potential that a formalized savings plan could have. And we know a lot of what we don't know. This is not a simple task, and we are only beginning to understand what the issues could be. The Foundation's portfolio around youth financial services is still relatively young, but we're entering a very, very rich period with our partners. We have roughly 8 partners in this area. We have just started the whole area of midterm evaluations with partners, and we're beginning to draw out some learnings through that process. Our partners have market research studies on roughly 15 countries or more, including Save the Children's research work. We expect a synthesis of this work late 2012. Two of our partners are expecting to publish financial diaries on young people in the next year. And we expect roughly 10 toolkits and guides coming out in the next year and a half, providing insights, resources, and tools to support those who are working with financial services for this segment. Today, we're thrilled with the YouthSave Consortium to announce and release the publications that Jamie spoke about. 2 years ago, MasterCard Foundation launched this partnership with the consortium to explore the financial and developmental impacts of savings on low-income youth in 4 developing countries: Ghana, Nepal, Colombia, and Kenya. The project works with 4 banks in those countries and worked with them to offer financial products and marketing targeted towards 12 to 18-year-old young people. Financial education is a part of that project, and the research component is designed to gain a really deeper understanding of the impact on young people. What are their preferences, their behavior around money? Research and analysis is also being taken to understand the regulatory and the contextual environment. Also, what is the business case for banks looking to serve this client segment? We do know that environment and context matters. We also know that we have a lot left to learn. This is a very unique project for us at the foundation. We're thrilled to share this day with them in this event. We're 2 years into the project. We're starting to gather some really interesting early learnings. And so we're very excited about the reports. The focus of today's event as well, youth and their money, is also really appropriate. This project and the work more broadly is in service of the young people that it works with. And at a time when the microfinance sector has really struggled with reputation challenges, the financial crisis, and other operating risks, our refocus on the client, and today that client is the young person, is really essential. So we're bringing the focus on that young person as a client today. So I really look forward to a rich discussion with our panelists. Thank you for all of your work. This is going to be great. We're anxious to learn what you have learned through your research and your findings on this topic, and we're anxious to hear and listen to what they're telling us about their dreams and aspirations. So once again, welcome, thank you, and look forward to the discussion.
Good afternoon, everyone. I'm really happy to be here. My name is Kelly Hallman. I am with the Population Council. I'm based in New York, but the Pop Council has offices in upwards of 18 different countries around the world. I'm an economist, but I've been working for the last 14 years in multidisciplinary teams to really look at how interventions and policies can be strengthened to build the assets of young people, particularly young people who are marginalized, socially excluded, financially excluded, etc. We've been doing this work in Latin America, in Sub-Saharan Africa, and also in South Asia. So it's a rather global portfolio. I think we can just go straight to the panelists. I will introduce each one just ever so briefly because I believe we're constrained for time. So our first speaker will be Tanya Kilara from CGAP. The second will be Katya Peterson with PSI. And the third will be Ronnie Deshpande with Save the Children. And then the fourth will be Lisa Johnson from the Center for Social Development. Okay, thanks.
Good afternoon. My name is Tanya Kilara, and I lead our youth work at CGAP. I'm a part of the clients and products team at CGAP. And really, I thought what Ruth said was perfect. The financial inclusion industry is really refocusing on clients, and we created this special team at CGAP called the Clients and Products team about a little over a year ago to actually focus in on the client. And for us, youth is a really important client segment that we're looking at specifically, in addition to another couple of client segments. So it's really a pleasure to be here today. And what I want to do as part of this panel, and it's a little more formal than I expected, but I wasn't quite sure whether to use my slides or not, but what I want to do is to just do a little bit of context setting and share with you how we've been thinking about youth and finance. And so we participate in the YouthSave project, but we stepped back a few months ago and we said, okay, if we have to actually look at what's the role of finance in youth lives, and for us really it's lower income youth in developing countries, what does that mean? Like, what really is the role? And so we did some scoping work. We spoke to several experts in the field. We spoke to funders, we spoke to academics, we spoke to practitioners to actually get a sense of what's happening in the youth landscape. And one thing we saw was that and we're talking today about understanding demand on this panel. So really segmentation becomes very important, and you'll hear a lot about segmentation as we go through the panel. But one thing we saw was that primarily, a lot of the segmentation in the youth space, especially in the youth financial services space, is done on the basis of age. So it's, are they minors or majors? Sometimes it's done by educational status. So are they in school, out of school, or lower income, higher income? But it's when you predominantly look at it, it's through that lens of age-based segmentation. And now I think that's an extremely valuable way of looking at it, and there's a lot of discussion in the field about, you know, what age actually makes up youth. But I think one thing that it does is that way of looking at it misses out looking at youth lives holistically. So to say, okay, you know, if we have to look at this young person, not just on the basis of how old they are, but if you have to look at everything that's going on in their lives, the age-based segmentation actually missed something. So we really said, okay, if we have to look at it from a life cycle approach and look at it, what can we say? And one lens that we found especially useful, this was proposed in the World Development Report 2007, was the lens of transitions. And the transitions lens is very quite widely used in other youth development work, but it's not been as used in youth financial services. And so really at this point, this is just a proposal for you to look at, think about. We'd love to engage in a dialogue with you, get your feedback about it, but just wanted to present one way of actually looking at youth financial lives through this lens of transitions. Great. So the way we see it, transitions are something that all youth have in common. And these transitions are to do with learning. So how are they actually gaining the skills, the education to actually be able to lead an economically productive life later on? So to do with learning, to do with working. So how do they actually make the transition from into the workforce? And then there are other, what we're calling life events. So there's marriage, there's actually starting a family. Youth that often go through the other transition, which is the one where they're picking up civic responsibility. So voting ages in most countries are 18, so they're actually beginning to become politically aware, start voting. So and in the lives of lower income youth, now these transitions happen with everyone, in all youth, pretty much everywhere in the world. But when you look at lower income youth, what's different is that these transitions often happen earlier, and they happen in a very compressed time frame. So in the lives of higher income youth, you might see that this is a pretty linear transition. They first go to school, then they go to college, then they enter the workforce. Sometime then they get married, have children. So it's quite a linear transition. In the lives of lower income youth, these are really compressed. So a girl living in the slums of Rio, she might be in school, but she's also working on the side to support herself. She might even have children that she has to care for. So if you look at it, there's a number of transitions that are going on in the life of that young person. So, and recognizing this, the complex reality of these transitions actually helps us better understand what the financial service needs of youth are, and what this combination, you already heard this, of some financial services that youth need, but they're also non-financial services. So really looking at transitions helps us to more smoothly weave together what the financial services and non-financial services needs of these youth actually are. So I want to talk a little bit about the financial service needs or the financial service implications of these three transitions. So when you look at learning, so how are they gaining the skills? So I keep saying skills because it might be education, it might be vocational training, but how are they actually gaining skills for them to enter the workforce? Now, if they're going to school, they might need often for lower income families, it's not that they have the money to send their kids to school. Either they have to save, or they might need to access credit to actually be able to educate youth. This doesn't even address the issue of quality of education or whether that education actually ensures employment. There are also other financial services that you can look at, like there's a lot of talk about conditional cash transfers, which are often government payments that are made to lower income families, which have a condition of actually, which set up incentives for youth to stay in school longer. So that's along the learning transition. And as you start thinking about it, there are actually like many, many more financial service needs that you'll see, but I just want to highlight a few. The second one along working, and I know Rani will talk about this in great detail later, which is youth are economically active, whether they're in school, out of school, they're actually earning money, and they have full, rich economic lives. So financial services can help them acquire skills. So that's one thing, just actually give them access to those skills. They often might need insurance or savings, which could protect them against a sudden loss of employment or prolonged unemployment. If you look at the whole issue of youth entrepreneurship, I think there are two types of youth entrepreneurs. So one is just youth who have been forced into entrepreneurship because there are no other economic opportunities for them. Those youth, at the very least, have requirements for working capital. If they're for youth who are naturally entrepreneurial and want to actually grow and scale these businesses, they would need other services. They would need micro equity, for instance. There also are like a whole set of non-financial services that they would need. They would need mentoring. They would need business connections, connections to the market. The other, I think, interesting element around working is the whole issue of migration. And you can talk at length about migration, but when we interviewed a provider in India, they said, okay, in India, what happens very often is that youth migrate from rural areas to urban areas and then engage in extremely hard labor. And what that does is actually changes their time frames because they know they can work between the ages of 20 and 40. And at 40, they know they retire, like their body can't do it anymore. These youth might be suddenly much more willing to save for retirement, to actually think about retirement, which for other youth just is so far away that they wouldn't even think about it. So so there are really a whole set of financial service implications there. Along the managing life events, there's families can save, access credit for marriages, insurance can help with health emergencies. So really along all these financial services, there's likely to be, in some cases, more of a public policy case, in some cases, actually incentives for the private sector to be able to provide these services. And but I think what is clear is that youth really have a complex set of financial service needs, but not a lot of them are being met right now, or they're being met to a small extent. Of that. So currently there are about 4.2 million youth served. This was a survey that Making Sense conducted in 2009, where with about $186 million in credit, about $48 million in savings, $1.2 million in insurance. And but there are a number of missed opportunities. The World Bank released data recently, which is the Global Findex, which showed that youth are 33% less likely to own a bank account than adults. They're also, if you look at lending portfolios, only outreach to young actually represents only about 10 to 20% of the lending portfolios of most partners, even though if you look at the population, the youth make up 30 to 50%. Good, so I'm actually, so the big point I want you to take away from this is that youth are, they have a set of financial service needs, but they're currently not being completely served. And you'll hear today from a number of practitioners who are actually going, speaking to youth to better understand these needs, you and then say how we can serve these youth. You'll hear from Katia next about looking at it from a completely different lens, and she'll talk about that. And then we'll have both Rani and Lisa talk about work that we've done in YouthSave. So thank you very much, and we'll be back later to answer questions. Thank you.
Does my PowerPoint magically appear? Oh. Okay.
It will magically appear.
Excellent.
There I like magic. Thank you. Thank you, everybody. My name is Katja Peterson. I am a researcher at Population Services International, kind of right next door on 19th Street. I was not part of the YouthSave project. Ronnie has asked me here to contribute my knowledge about market segmentation in youth. Our experience has been more on the health sector, engaging with youth. So PSI, for those of you who are not aware, we are a social marketing organization. We are in 72 countries around the world. We focus on branding, family planning, and reproductive health products like condoms, IUDs, those types of deliverables. And then we also run franchises for service delivery. Youth make up a bulk of our target audience. So it's very important for us to understand their behaviors. We specialize on, especially my office and research, we focus on segmenting target groups based on behavior. Particularly, we use the OAM framework, which stands for opportunity, ability, and motivation. It's with the understanding that just because a youth is not empowered to make a decision about a condom doesn't necessarily mean they're disempowered everywhere in their life. So it's taking into account when we do our research that empowerment can be fluid. Economics has been shown to play a lot in that youth who are more financially secure are more likely to make smarter choices about their reproductive health. PSI is just about to roll out our 5-year strategic plan. The crux of it is a total market approach. I will admit here in front of everybody, I am a public health, global health researcher. I am not a financial person, so I am learning a lot about this. So essentially, you will probably know more than I do, but it's essentially growing the market as a whole. We're not interested in crowding out the local condom supplier or the other distributor. Rather, we want to grow the entire market. We just want more condom users out there anyway. And that's essentially, unlike Coke or Pepsi, that's perhaps, you know, the tack that we take. So this also ensures that everyone in the target group has access to a health product or services that's in their price range. And essentially, we're redefining success, which can be a bit difficult when you're reporting on indicators and whatnot. PSI uses the archetype Sarah, who we call her Sarah, and whatever we do, we bring it back to, is this good for Sarah? Does this work for Sarah? Is this good for Sarah and her family? We define success now not always in DALYs, which are disability-adjusted life years, or CYPs, which are contraception years of protection, but rather we see the gains for Sarah, our Sarah's needs being met, whether that comes from us or the total market. And this dovetails very nicely with the YouthSave project because financial empowerment is so important to their health. One of the things that we do to learn a little bit more about our demographic, we use a tool called Focus. PSI likes to brand condoms and every single tool that we use. So there is a name for everything. Essentially, this is a focus group discussion in a box. It comes prepackaged for people to be able to use in the field, and it will come with an interview discussion guide, themes to analyze for, interpretations, coding for keywords. Essentially, that this is not just a focus group discussion for the sake of having a focus group. It's largely driven by the marketing team, and I'll show you an example of the type of questions that the marketing team will want to know. As I said, it's a suite of tools. It could be either photo narratives, interview guides, focus group discussions, collage making. I talked a little bit about the OAM framework already. We use this to gain insight into the audience we're trying to reach, just as you would for any basic qualitative research. Importantly, this is a collaborative process between programmers, marketers, researchers and sometimes members of the target audience, especially when we're doing interpretations. So it is not just a researcher in their room by theirself. It's very interactive. Just very quickly, these are some of the tools that we use the most. Flash focus is a quick and dirty way to get what you want to know. It is often used when a marketer, they release their condom, and they want to know very quickly what people like or don't like about it. And it might just be one or two questions, sweet and to the point. We've also got tools for focus on traders or vendors that we will use. Focus on providers. These are healthcare providers. We'll sit down and do an FGD with them. Focus for marketing planning. And focus on qualitative segmentation. And this is what I'm discussing a bit about this. So just to summarize, we're essentially looking at beliefs to reinforce and beliefs to change. We want to build a profile about this person, an archetype, and I'll show you an example of that. We also want to, we use this to understand current brand positions. This could be and what they associate that brand with. So we've got two condoms in South Africa. One is marketed towards, you know, that guy who just loves to get out on a Friday night and likes his women. The other one is to the more conservative couple who want to use it more for family planning. We create a category map that shows us what are the competing products, services, behaviors that might go against the successful marketing. And then we also develop segmentation diagrams to guide marketers towards the determinants that they can best influence. And I'll present a quick case study here. This is the Salama condom from Tanzania. So Salama had been on the market for a while, and there were now competitors who were starting to creep in up on its space. The tack that they take is let's give that market to somebody else, and we'll go find another niche that nobody's in. So they wanted to know how they could reposition and remarket Salama. So the purpose was to gather information about 18 to 29-year-olds, and they wanted to know, marketers, strength of Salama as a brand, how it's perceived, who are the current customers, do they need to do an image revitalization, and also providing insight. And this is just a quick picture of the interpretation session of us working all together. And then this is what we come up with. This is the final, what we call a dashboard, and this is what goes to the marketing team. And I won't go through this one. There are examples actually out on the table. You're free to grab one. But this is, we put it together in archetype, and we actually put names and pictures, and this is Frida. Frida is the single mother who does not want to get pregnant again. She wants to focus on employment, building her own business. And this is essentially what we get from all the focus groups and in-depth interviews. It comes in this nicely little neat package dashboard that we give out. That is it for my very, very brief presentation. It was just of an overview, but please feel free to contact me if you have any other questions or comments. We're very excited that to have more of a holistic approach to these types of issues. So thank you.
Waiting for some more magic. Gotta believe. There we go. Hi, my name is Ronnie Deshpande, and I'm the director of the YouthSave Project based at Save the Children. And thank you, Katya and Danaya, for some really fascinating insights. Ruth has already told you a little bit about the YouthSave Project, so I'll skip that and just say that one of the objectives of the project is to design and test sustainable savings accounts for low-income adolescents in the four countries that we work in. That's Colombia, Ghana, Kenya, and Nepal again. And we have a very ambitious research agenda, which is looking at the outcomes and the impact of those savings accounts. But right now, I'm going to walk you through the design half of that design and test objective. But first, let me recap what we've learned so far through our market research that we implemented to design these savings accounts. A couple of key findings. First, we found that even low-income youth do have some money. It's in small amounts, But contrary to popular belief, these are not kids without some financial resources. And because they have financial resources, they're making financial decisions all the time about whether and where to spend and to save. And finally, they're saving mainly through informal mechanisms, places around the house, trusted others, but really for some of the same reasons and with some of the same misgivings as their sort of small saver adult counterparts. And we think that this actually suggests a market opportunity for financial services providers that can position themselves to compete on superior safety and acceptable convenience. So you can stop paying attention now because I've just told you everything you need to know. But if you'd like to know more, you might ask, how do we know all this? It's not by turning off the slides. There we go. We know all this because we talked to over 2,000 youth in these four countries, aged 12 to 18, mostly from lower income segments, as well as almost 500 adult kind of gatekeepers or influencers, by which I mean parents, teachers, community leaders, older youth leaders. And we did this research. It was designed to shed light on kind of the multiple dimensions of youth behavior that you'd need to know about in order to design a good savings product for these kids, as well as complementary financial education programming. So these are a couple of the sort of really key dimensions that we investigated, which included, what do they do in their daily lives? How do they think about spending and saving? What kinds of savings tools might they need? And how do they like to learn about financial information and information in general? We did this through, I have to say, nothing as sophisticated and really amazing sounding as what Katya does, but mainly qualitative work as well, which took the form of, in most countries, two rounds of focus groups. One, very sort of open-ended and formative to really elicit kids' views on these issues. And then the second, much more focused, to get their reactions to specific product prototype ideas built around what we found out about these questions. We did do our segmentation for the formative focus groups anyway, on a combination of demographic and behavioral dimensions. So we actually split our 2,000 plus respondents into 16 different subsegments along the dimensions of gender, schooling status, location, and whether they were older or younger adolescents, so sort of 12 to 15 versus 16 to 18. And we did this not because we wanted to design 16 different savings products. That is not a path to sustainability that I know of. But rather, we wanted to see how diverse youth needs and preferences with respect to savings were across these subsegments so that we could actually identify commonalities and design a savings product that would hopefully appeal to the largest possible cross-section of young people. So some of what we found, actually through these conversations, is quite consistent with what you would expect to find, you know, for anyone who's familiar with the literature on adult small savers. First of all, as I said, these kids do have money. And that really surprised a lot of people that we shared these findings with. You know, the adults that I mentioned we spoke to before, oftentimes the first question that we would get is, what are you talking about, youth savings? A, youth don't have money, so they can't save. And if they do have money, they're not getting it for any place good. We hear that a lot. When you talk to the kids, you find out that, no, they do have money, small amounts. But they do have money, and most of it actually comes from their parents. And they talk quite fluently about the amounts that they get from their parents, and you'll see the range here. It was quite a range across the four different countries and even, you know, within the countries. But we found mainly two forms that kids get money from the family overall. The first, and that's what's cited here, are kind of in the form of allowances. You know, a lot of money that's given for like buying school lunches or snacks or covering daily needs like transportation. And so those are smaller amounts, but tend to be more regular. So people talked about getting an allowance every week, every couple of days, like twice a week, sometimes on a daily basis. They also talked about a second form, which is a little bit higher amounts, but much less regular, and those are in the form of gifts. Those tend to come in around holiday times, about around in-migration time, so where the adults in their lives are coming back home with money. So some of the amounts that we heard cited tended to be larger than the bottom end of this range for sure. So, for example, in Ghana, an amount around $13 US appeared to be typical for gifts. In Nepal, it ranged from $1 to $14, so you know, quite a bit more than the sort of allowance amounts. In addition, kids also reported receiving money from work, and most of the kids that we spoke to reported receiving money from work, at least on a part-time basis. This could be, you know, this is obviously more among out-of-school youth, but also among in-school youth who might work, you know, either around the house or in their family businesses or outside the family altogether. And these are some of the amounts that we heard, the ranges of the amounts that we heard from those kids. And you see, again, the same sort of diversity of amounts because kids really vary in how much they work, both in between and across countries. So because this is qualitative work, it was very hard to get a hard and fast sense of how much kids were making exactly and how much they were spending. The next slide shows you, we did talk about them though, this slide, what it's meant to depict is kind of a relative sense of what kids said they were spending their money on. And you see the most frequently mentioned category by far, and maybe that's because we were talking to lower income kids, was basic needs. So things like food at school, clothing, personal care items, especially for girls, that was very important, school supplies, transportation. The next category were a bit more discretionary expenses, so the occasional contributions to household expenses, and also various forms of entertainment. A lot of cyber cafes, cell phone airtime cards. I don't know if you can count that as entertainment, but it's certainly discretionary. And then there was actually a third, less frequently mentioned, but a third category of where these kids' money was going to, and that was savings. And they mentioned this not only as a sort of, you know, destination in and of itself, but also as a means of coping with the financial pressure that they feel to meet with these other basic needs expenses. And they mentioned two goals, short-term and long-term goals. The short-term goals really corresponded very much to the basic needs side of the expenses. But they also mentioned these long-term goals that they had. Education across both in and out of school kids, either to continue it or to get back into it. The out of school kids also mentioned saving up to start a business, and then all types of kids mentioned saving for emergencies. I'm getting the stop signal, so I'm going to go quickly through the rest of our findings. As I mentioned before, the vast majority of these kids, see, that's why I gave the findings up front. The vast majority of these kids were saving informally. There are certain likes and certain dislikes that they have. The top three should sound familiar to anybody who's looked at small savings before: accessibility, simplicity, privacy. Accessibility, the money is always there when you want it. Simplicity, the piggy bank doesn't ask you to fill out a form every time you want to take money out. And the privacy wrinkle was interesting because, and this explains the discrepancy between what adults thought and what kids thought. The people that they want to keep their savings private from mostly are their parents and family members. And partially this is out of just a desire, a growing desire for autonomy that you know, characterizes this age range of kids. And partially it's because of fear of what might happen if their parents found out about the savings, either expropriation or fears of loss of parental support. On the downside of informal savings, though, you have insecurity, and the kids recognize that it's really subject to loss or theft, and also accessibility. The same accessibility that they like, they also recognize can make it not that easy for kids to accumulate longer term, larger sums. And so here's where we think the opportunity for financial services providers might lie, in helping kids come up with tools to accumulate larger lump sums over a longer term that can really bump them up into the next set of economic opportunities that it's very difficult for them to save for right now. These are quickly, so this is what we're working with our bank partners on. These are the four product brands. These products have been, the savings accounts have been rolled out nationally across the four countries over the last couple of months. And we're going to be monitoring this intensively, obviously, but one of the great sources of data that are going to be coming out of the project is what Liz is going to be talking about next, which is a demographic and transactions database that is actually going to track the usage, every single transaction, every single account opened under this project. So we'll be, a couple years hence, able to say a lot more about how these kids are actually doing in these accounts. And I will stop there.
Good afternoon. Are you all still here? Okay.
My name is Lissa Johnson. I'm with the Center for Social Development at Washington University, and I've been there for 15 years and still working and doing. We're very excited to be a part of the YouthSave project. Before my clock starts, I would like to make some acknowledgments, because the YouthSave project is very large, and the research that we're doing is extensive and multi-method, and there's a lot of people that are involved. So really, first of all, I want to thank MasterCard Foundation for their funding support. But I also want to, if I know how to make this go down. Which way does it go? Oh, perfect. Okay, I figured it out. But I also want to acknowledge the research partners that are involved in this. We have a lot of folks, and not only the research partners, but also the financial institutions. We haven't really named them. I will be talking about them. But I want to give recognition to the University of Los Andes in Colombia, the University of Ghana Institute of Statistical, Social, and Economic Research, the Kenya Institute for Public Policy Research and Analysis, New Era in Nepal, the University of North Carolina School of Social Work, who are doing the impact study in Ghana, and the Columbia are leading it, and then the Columbia University School of Social Work. So a lot of people that are involved in this process. And I don't want to forget, you know, when we start talking about data, it's very easy to forget about the youth. For the data that we've collected, we had to get consent from them. And so I really want to give a thanks to the young people for allowing us to learn from them. Okay. So today, I did say we have multi-methods. The method that I'm presenting in terms of data today is from the savings demand assessment, is what we call that. And it answers the research question, which youth, household, and saving product characteristics are associated with positive savings outcomes? And in order to answer that question, no small task, we asked the financial institutions to add some additional questions to their account open forms so that we can get some additional demographic information from them. And then they also provide for us, as Ronnie mentioned, the account transactions of those youth over the entire life of the project. So we will be getting a wealth of information. And this afternoon, we only have a brief time, so I'm just going to give you just a little snapshot of the data that we have received from the product rollout, from the product pilot, which was data that we were building up in order to develop the rollout product. And in order to one of the findings that we're finding from that are who saves, amount of savings, how many are saving, what are their patterns of savings, and what are the characteristics that are associated with savings. So it will be a wealth of information that we get over time. So for the product pilot, we started with the market research, and the next phase was to do a pilot of the product to test and two of the major questions in the product pilot was to ask, are the banks attracting the target population? Are they able to get low-income youth, ages 12 to 18, to be willing to sign up for the account? And then second of all, are the youth actually making deposits? Are they wanting to use this account? In other words, if we build it, will they come? And if we provide an accessible, attractive savings product and services that go along with that, will they save in a formal saving structure? In addition to that, we also are asking where do we need to tweak the product and the processes in order for them to be able to save more and to help contribute to their ability to save. So just to give you a context for the product pilot, the piloting happened in three of the four countries. In Colombia, there was no pilot, so we don't have pilot data on that. So we're focusing on the HFC Bank in Ghana, Post Bank in Kenya, and Bank of Kathmandu in Nepal. The piloting was between July and December of this past year. Now, not all of the pilots were limited in time and scope, and the pilots in Ghana started at different times from Kenya and Nepal, and even the branches that participated, and notice that we have a limited number of branches that were participating, so remember, this is a small-scale pilot at this point in time, started at different times. So when we look at the data, please take that into consideration. These numbers are not large, but it just gives us an indication of how things are going. As you can see in Ghana, they actually had the average number of days account was open was twice as large as in Kenya and Nepal. They had that earlier start. And then the total accounts opened, you'll notice there's a difference between the number of accounts that are in the study, and that means those that gave consent, the youth that gave consent to allow us to learn from them, versus the total number of accounts that were open. So there will be some differences in the overall total number versus the ones that are actually in our study. It's still a very high number. We're going to learn a lot from those who did give consent, and we're very excited about that. So what did we learn? In answering the first question, had the banks attracted the target population? Looking at just a few of the demographics here, what's interesting is in terms of gender, you'll note there's three interesting things about that, that there is an equal distribution between boys and girls who signed up for accounts. The second interesting thing is it's that way across all three countries. So we have a really nice equal distribution in all of those countries, a nice pattern to see. And then thirdly, what you don't see on the slide is that when we were looking at the saving patterns and characteristics between the boys and the girls, there was no statistical significantly difference in between in the savings. So that was encouraging to see as well. But again, this is pilot data, so we have to leave all of our precautionary statements that go along with that, and we will continue to track that. In terms of the age, at a time of account opening, it was average of 14, so we are getting the kids, are recruiting the kids from between the ages of 12 and 18, which was the target. In terms of previous experience in a formal account, very few of the young people reported having a prior formal financial account, which means these are new clients for the financial institutions, which is good news. They're reaching out and getting new clients into the bank. In terms of school enrollment, most of the kids were in school. Most of the kids were not out of school youth. We are targeting both, but in terms of the piloting anyway, most of the banks were targeting the in-school youth. The marketing that was going on was really towards kids who are in school, so that number is a logical reflection of that. In terms of income, are we reaching low-income youth? We developed, as part of the account opening forms that we asked them to fill out, looking at the minimum monthly wage in each country and then categorizing based on that. We find that the young people reported, most of them are in the first three categories. So the majority of them really are in the lower income category, we believe. So we will continue to look at that. You will see that in Ghana, for example, there is a larger number that were reporting five times or more the minimum wage. When we looked at that, we found that there was one branch that actually had a concentration of that number. So it may be something special that's going on at that branch where they were attracting a higher income group of youth. So we will continue to look at that information over time. When we look at the reasons that the young people are saving, this, I think, fits in with what Ronnie found in the market research, and that is that the majority of them say they are saving for their own education. So this is also encouraging. I think they're getting the messaging that this is a savings account that's not just meant to be a transaction account, but to continue to save over time for their asset in terms of education. So that's pretty exciting to see, and again, we'll keep watching that. Now, the second question is, are the young people saving? Pardon me, I say kids. I tend to be very vernacular about this. I'm an older person, so I think of them as young people. But the young people are saving. And again, these numbers are not very indicative at this point because, remember, they've only been saving for about 40 days or 90 days in Ghana. But they are saving. There are some withdrawals that are happening. And you'll notice in Ghana there's a little bit more in terms of withdrawals. But you have to remember that that is in part a reflection of the fact that there is an ATM card that they can get. There's a service fee attached to that, which is about 4 CDs, I believe. And since rollout has happened, they've actually lowered the cost of that fee. So that explains at least a little bit of those withdrawals. But by and large, there's really not very many withdrawals that were happening as of that time. We will also be able to look at the average savings per account. Again, this is a short period of time, so these data are not as meaningful as they will be, a little bit later, but it gives you an idea of the kind of information we're going to be able to report. I would draw your attention to the last one. I don't know if you can see. It says average monthly net savings. That is the dependent variable that we will be using to analyze what characteristics are significantly associated with savings outcomes. So that's a very quick snapshot because my time limit is already up, and I've got lots and lots more data, but we won't present it all today. And actually, the next step really is to not focus so much on the product pilot, but now to be looking at the rollout data. The launch has happened now as of April in most of the countries. So now we will really be able to look at what's happening. We'll get comprehensive analysis of the savings patterns of the young people. We'll be able to link that savings data to the workshop participation that the young people are participating in to see what kind of effect that has on their saving performance. We'll also be able to link this to experiments. We have an experiment in Ghana. We'll be able to look at the effects of the savings on health and academic achievement. Speaking to Katia, this will relate to your health work. We'll also be able to, also in Ghana is the experiment with in-school banking, so we'll be able to look at any of the effects of in-school banking on savings performance. And then also in Colombia, we're hoping to do experiment with text messaging from the financial institution and looking at the effects of those messaging on savings performance. We may also be able to do that same kind of experiment in Kenya. So we have lots and lots and lots of data that will be forthcoming as the project continues to roll out. And again, we thank the youth greatly for this great learning that we will be learning from them.
Okay, that was indeed a whirlwind tour packed full of information. So I think we'll open it up to the floor now. Just to clarify, how long do we have for the discussion period? 20? Okay. So I have a whole list of questions, but I want to open it up to the people who really made the big effort to come here first. So please, let me know what you'd like to find out. Anyone? Yes.
I'll start. I'm curious about the...
Please introduce yourself too, briefly, if you could.
Hi, my name is Anne Folan, and I'm interested in the institutional side of it from a couple of perspectives. First of all, what the reaction was of the partner institutions, how you found them, whether there was any skepticism on the part of the bank leadership or the rank and file tellers. And then also a little bit about Ms. Johnson's presentation. What were the product attributes? Was it apples to apples across the pilot countries, or were some term and some demand? Or if you could just give us a little bit of the perspective of how it worked from the operational side. Thanks so much.
Okay, why don't we go ahead with that question?
Okay, so your question is about in terms of what the product characteristics were?
Right, if they were consistent across the entire pilot, or if they differed by country, or?
You would be a better person to answer that question, but that they were all savings accounts, standard savings accounts. Now, I will say that there weren't a lot of changes. So in Nepal, for example, there was a dual account structure. So there was a fixed account, savings account combination. And by the time we get to roll out, they realized it was better to just have a savings account rather than to have a more complex dual account system. They had, everybody had minimum deposits. It was a savings account in the young person's name. Some of them were custodial accounts. What else?
The major other difference is for the Ghana account, they don't allow withdrawals for the first 3 months, okay. And then a maximum of one withdrawal per month thereafter.
And they had different incentives in the sense that Ghana, for example, offered an ATM card that you could do. You could look at your account. You couldn't really make deposits or withdrawals on that. There was variation in answer. Is the short answer. There was variation across, but there were some consistencies across as well.
And interest paid on the accounts?
the interest is paid. The rates were very minimal.
I would say the exception to that is that was the fixed account portion in Nepal, just because it's a high interest rate environment. So in real terms, again, you're talking minimal returns. We chose not to emphasize the interest part of the product features for a couple of different reasons. One, our project view is that these accounts should be as sustainable as possible for the financial institutions. And the other thing that research has shown is that kids don't really respond to financial incentives in the same way that adults do. Instead, when, Lisa talks about incentives, we're talking much more about in-kind incentives and giveaways. So all of the accounts actually offer a piggy bank for the kids to sort of accumulate their day-to-day money in between trips to the bank. And then various institutions offer other kinds of giveaways, like a savings diary in Kenya. And then also in Kenya, they were doing a little savings bag. Now they're doing a wallet mm-hmm. instead. In Ghana, they're doing sort of T-shirts and pens as promotional items on a sort of not ad hoc basis, but on different periodic bases.
Okay, who's next? Yes.
Hi, Alexandra Fiorillo from Ideas 42. So I came out from your presentation on the data that's actually being made available. So the withdrawals I thought was really interesting, because you said that, I think that the observation was, they're not withdrawing a lot of money, but just sort of quick, I don't remember the numbers exactly, but it looked about 20-25% already being withdrawn. But if they're only saving for about 40 days, 90 days in the Ghana experience, it seems like a fairly high amount of money is being withdrawn. So
there are a few people that were making larger withdrawals,
okay.
But most of the young people weren't making.
So do you have
any,
a baseline for what you would think sort of a high amount or a low amount of withdrawals would be that you're relating that to, or is it just a sort of a cultural or sort of qualitative observation?
I think because I was looking at the data in terms of who, I mean, I didn't give how many per child gave, but when you look at the average withdrawal amount, it was like 0.04 in the data, as opposed to in Ghana, it was a little bit higher, of course, and they had more opportunity to and more time to withdraw.
Anyone else? Yes.
Hi, Stephanie Halligan with CFED. So looking at the survey data that you've already collected and looking at the data you will be collecting in the next few months, I guess what are the opportunities to learn from this and apply it to the domestic market here in the U.S., and what should we be a little cautious about when we're translating those findings to something in America?
You answer that.
That's a toughie.
Yeah. We're doing a variety of different work at CSD domestically and internationally, and I think we always believe that both can learn from each other in terms of the information, and in terms of what we've learned so far and what we've seen so far, there is some similarity in that in the CEDOK they were saving small amounts at one point. In some other projects they were saving small amount. This is just pilot data, so we can't really say anything at this point, but it looks like right now they're saving small amounts, so that doesn't look very dissimilar. And as we go forward, as we see more patterns, we'll be able to make those connections.
Yes.
Hi, I'm Mariko from Making Sense. Thanks all for a great panel. Ronnie, a question for you. Just wondering, what was the most heated discussion that you think at the financial institutions as they were weeding through all of the findings about, what they were surprised about and then what they discussed? What were sort of the sticking points for them, things about the product that they had a hard time, there was push and pull between the youth perspective, the financial service perspective, and as well as the research perspective?
Wow, that's a great question. And it actually, I think, goes to the second part of Anne's question as well. Mm-hmm. When we selected our bank partners, who incidentally are Banco Caja Social in Colombia, HFC Bank, as Lisa mentioned, in Ghana, Kenya Post Bank in Kenya, and the Bank of Kathmandu in Nepal, we had actually done a little bit of a sort of a competitive process to select those partners. We went out on our sort of prospecting trips and talked to a lot of different financial institutions, 8 to 10 in each country. And then we asked asked those who we thought were sort of appropriate for the project and interested to submit written expressions of interest with a little bit more details to their plans. So already right there, you're getting a little bit of a pre-selection that there weren't financial institutions who were completely skeptical or not enthusiastic about seeing the potential for trying out this market anyway, who would have even come up for participation. So I think the conversations we had with these partners are a little bit different than you would have had with a sort of typical run-of-the-mill financial institution. That said, I think each of them faces a different sort of balancing act internally with respect to how much investment they can put in this product. Because youth savings products, especially targeting a low-income market, and I should specify that we are not insisting that these banks target only low-income kids, because we do want the product to be as sustainable as possible. However, our project, and certainly Save the Children's involvement, really focuses on the needs of low-income kids. And we did the market research with 75 to 100% low-income kids because we wanted to make sure that those product designs responded to their needs. And that's one thing that's really encouraging to me about the pilot data that we're getting is that we have sized the door so that low-income kids can walk through it, and they are. Now, who else comes through that door, who primarily comes through that door, is also a function of marketing, as Lissa mentioned. And so now that we're going into full-scale rollout, we'll be paying a lot of attention to that. But to bring it back, these institutions all have different set points with respect to the amount of investment that they can put in. It is a long-term investment. You know, you're putting in direct costs right now, you're putting in staff costs right now to cultivate the next generation of clients, but that investment is going to pay off in terms of revenue after a number of years. So how much we were able to make the product features really correspond quite closely to what the market research was telling us really depended on that. And in some countries, the banks were willing to invest a bit more. And in some countries, their internal processes and their internal hurdles for getting a product approved stipulated that you had to show break-even in X number of years. And so we had to make compromises there. But I'm really encouraged to see that across the countries we have data for so far, we are getting over half of the account holders from the bottom three income segments.
I'd like to also add that one of the things that we hope to be also able to connect is any cross-sale products. And so as many of you know, that's one of the big issues. If you can build up a larger portfolio from these accounts, it begins to pay off a little more as well. And we hope that we'll be able to track that and see, well, wow, you know, some of these accounts, you know, added, you know, this blown or this, that, and the other. And over time, we hope we'll be able to make some statements about that as well.
Just a last comment to build on what both Rani and Lissa said, and CGAP's looking at the business case for youth saving, so that's what we'll be doing in the YouthSave project. And one thing I wanted to mention was that we are supporting, so in terms of the financial institutions and their readiness to take this on, I think they all saw a market opportunity, but we also supported them with the market research, with product design, and we're supporting them with marketing. So I think really how sustainable these products are going to be will depend. We'll see it at the point when the project is done and what institutions actually end up doing with these products once the project is up. The other thing, tension point, I think one place, and I won't say which institution, but I think one place I saw this tension between what youth wanted. Youth really want flexibility in their accounts. They want to be able to withdraw when they need it. And if you see, they're using it for emergency, so you can see why they would want that. But from a bank's perspective, the more withdrawals that happen, the more transactions that happen, it's more expensive. So in one of the banks, that was definitely a pull that we saw with youth saying, we want more withdrawals, and the bank saying, we can allow one or two withdrawals a year, and that's it. That's where we have to cap it, because that's what makes business sense for us. So that's one place we saw it. Thanks.
Yes.
I just have a quick question about the research design. I came in late and I might have missed this, but are you following at all other people in the household, the parents or others? Do they have accounts? Or are they opening accounts too?
Yes. One of the questions, remember, in the savings demand assessment, we have to keep in mind that it's not a survey. It's a few additional questions we were allowed for the to ask in the account opening form. And remember, there's a trade-off between how long it takes for somebody to fill out an account opening form. So it's not a lengthy survey. But one of the questions that we are able to ask in this particular savings demand assessment is whether the parents have had prior experience with formal financial institutions. So do they have an account with the bank or with another financial institution? So we are asking that. In the experiment, there is a longer survey that's asked, and there are others here who may be able to speak to the questions that are in the experiment that ask a little bit more about the household and what their experience is.
Yeah, in the green there.
Hi, Elena Augustine, Counterpart International. I was wondering, what are some of the indicators that you're looking at for this to be considered a success in the future? And as you move on out of the pilot phase, are there certain countries that you're looking at expanding into?
Well, I think from a project point of view, we are, as Thanaya mentioned, looking at what do the financial institutions do with this product afterwards? Does it actually remain a part of their portfolio? That's going to be a huge indicator for us. On the client side, we are looking to the results of the savings demand assessment. So, you know, did kids come? Did they respond to this market offer? Were they able to build balances over time? And then looking to the results of the experiment in Ghana to say, so what? What impact did this have on their lives? Did it change their future orientation? Did it increase their financial capability? Did it have an effect on how well they do in school? Did it have an effect on other health-related behaviors? That's what we really care about. I don't know if you're asking about more specific research-related indicators, maybe, Alyssa, you could talk about that.
I think also, you know, I think we're also interested in their financial capabilities. So, you know, we asked the question, have you ever had, you know, prior experience with a formal financial institution? To us, that's a very interesting finding that we're getting a lot of these young people who have not. So, you know, theoretically, then that might be an indicator that, you know, we're building their... It's the access, you know. It goes back to the institutional structure. If you build it, will they come? And you know, are these kids taking up accounts? And who are these young people? Are they low income? And to us, I think it's, you know, if we get a large proportion, it doesn't have to be all of them, but a large proportion who are low income, who've never had an account before, that's certainly another indicator of success. It's not just about the money in the bank. It's about the access and the ability to participate in that whole process. And you know, it's almost a, you know, well, we can get into the human rights piece, but it's, you know, it's the ability to be a part of the economic and world and the market world. So there are all those other pieces in addition to a lot of the developmental outcomes that Ronnie already mentioned.
Can I do my
please?
Just from a
Hello? Okay, just from a health perspective as well to kind of chime in. One of the indicators that we look at from the health sector, particularly among low-income youth, is number of unplanned pregnancies. You know, HIV rate, STD rates, how often they visit a clinic. One of the biggest drivers for young poor girls, especially in Africa, is to take up with a sugar daddy for many reasons that they can't afford a lot of the cell phone, airtime, all of the other discretionary funds, entertainment. So for them, they can go and get their sugar daddy. But what is very interesting is when these girls are financially empowered, that sugar daddy has a lot less sway. Sugar daddies can oftentimes say, I'm your sugar daddy, we're not using a condom. But he's got all kinds of different, you know, women that he's sleeping with, thus putting them all at risk. So just by empowering that girl with a small financial incentive to say, hey, you know what, I don't need that extra $20 to have sex without a condom, you know. And those are things that we very, very look very closely at. Education plays also a very big role. We do a lot of work with girls' education and the health benefits. So at least from a health side, looking at those big national level indicators like teenage pregnancy, HIV rates, and could be very indicative of
having this. Adding on to that, you asked the question about how this informs domestically as well. You know, the research also talks about, you know, domestic violence and when you're more financially empowered, then the domestic violence piece goes down. So there's a lot of connections that will cross-inform.
Yes, absolutely.
Just a final comment on the YouthSave project. I think we have kind of two roles here. We're going in with a hypothesis that this makes a difference for youth, but we're all, it's also a very heavy research project. So at the same time, we're looking to see whether our hypotheses are actually going to play out or not. So in those terms, the indicator of success really is slightly less concrete because we're willing to learn and see how this plays out versus having one way it needs to go.
And I'd like to add one other piece to that, because actually the time frame of the project is not that long. So you can imagine, you know, so there is a question in the research, will we see, you know, I think it's a good question tonight, is will we see any outcomes in this short amount of time? We hope that we will, and we'll do what we can to extend if we need to, but I think it's an important question and important to know, you know, what time frame do you begin to see these changes?
I actually was interested in some of the requirements in terms of whether IDs are something a young person needs to have to open one of the accounts, because that's one of the things that we found in a lot of our research in developing countries, in particular for girls, because girls are, you know, much less in the marketplace and much less likely to have, say, you know, a paycheck or even an ID if there is a national ID available to young people. And the other thing I was interested in is, in some of the preparatory work that you did you use the term saving per se, or did you say something more like, are you putting money away for, you know, X, Y, and Z reason? Because at least in my experience, if you use the word saving, a lot of young people consider that something very formal that only a rich person does in a bank, you know, up on the hill in the capital city, whereas they don't realize that they're actually doing the same thing, but they just don't call it that.
Yeah, absolutely. So depending on the cultural context, we both made the distinction and said, when we say savings, what does that mean to you? And then kids gave us all these different, and they ranged from, oh, savings is in a bank, mm-hmm. Savings is what I put under my mattress. But like in some countries, for example, Colombia is the one that comes to mind because there's a linguistic distinction there. If you say ahorrar, mm-hmm. people think it's a bank, it's savings. But if you say guardar dinero, to keep money, that's what the language we had to use to be able to focus on the right behavior with the kids. So it was very important to know the cultural context and how kids think about stuff locally. And, you know, on that note, I just want to recognize the amazing work that our field staff have done in this project. I mean, we're, you know, sort of talking about it here, but the financial institutions, our Save the Children staff, our in-country research partners have put an incredible amount of work. And on that note, I want to recognize actually one of our field staff who is here. Jane May in the back is the director of programs at Save the Children Canada in Kenya and has been a real supporter of this work throughout. So glad you could come. And on the second question, IDs, huge, especially with out-of-school youth. And it's true that the pilot-level marketing really focused on in-school youth, but one of the reasons that we found it so difficult to focus on out-of-school youth in the beginning is the ID issue, a huge mm-hmm. obstacle for them.
Mm-hmm. Does anyone have any ideas on how to get around that?
Well, I think in Nepal, they actually made some changes. They mm-hmm. were able to loosen, and you could probably correct me a little bit, they were able to loosen. Before, you had to have a birth certificate from the government, et cetera, to open an account. Now you only need to have a letter
from the school.
It slightly loosens, but it makes it far more accessible than what it might have been otherwise. And
or like in Kenya, a letter from the chief of the locality is also now acceptable. So that's something that's easier to get if you don't have formal ID.
Mm-hmm. Okay, that's great.
Yeah, other countries also doing that. Like the Philippines is accepting school certificates. They just started accounts which kids can open from ages 7. Mm-hmm. And so that's, I think, quite an active conversation that's happening.
Okay, that's great to know.
And we, as Save the Children, you know, sort of as part of our child protection and child rights agenda, identity is a very big part of that. So one of the things we want to explore going forward, especially in working with out-of-school youth, is how can we help them do both? How mm-hmm. can we help them get papers and then sort of access all of the rights and benefits that go along with that?
Yeah, of course. I just had another quick question for Lisa. I noticed in I realize it's just pilot data at this point, but in the Kenya outcomes look different from the other countries that you showed in terms of amounts saved and just like the pattern in general looked different. And I didn't know if you were maybe reaching a different type of young person there, or if?
I don't think we know enough to say. However, what I can say is they had 12 branches that were participating, whereas the other two had four. Mm-hmm. And, you know, once you add more branches, that can make a distinction in terms of, you know, some marketing. We don't know, you know, the details of how the marketing happened. Mm-hmm. You know, who was in the neighborhood, who was participating. So I think it may become a little more equitable once they're rolled out to all branches, and mm-hmm. then we'll begin to see if there's really anything that's special or different about Kenya.
Right.
Unless you have other thoughts about Kenya.
That would be my thought as well. And I think also the amounts were in local currency, right? On the slide?
They were converted also.
Local currency and also the purchasing power parity.
They were very similar.
Yeah.
Yeah, when they were converted. I had one more question. On the determinants work, that will take place with the data that you're doing now, the rollout data. The determinants of who, you know, comes in for these services, et cetera, et cetera. You're going to do more work on that with data.
We had more of that work, but mm-hmm. Because it's so preliminary, and it's really not appropriate because, you know, one tends to start comparing and to lots of different. So I don't feel confident about presenting all of that for the pilot data, but we will definitely do a lot more, you know, bivariate analysis, multivariate analysis going forward, because I mean there's a wealth of data, and as Matt Despard pointed out to me that earlier, I'm kind of lost in the weeds of the data, but he reminds me that, you know, In a survey, the kids can tell you they're saving, but in this data, this is what they're actually doing. So this is real, and so we'll have a better idea of really what's happening.
It's like biomarkers with health reporting, right? go ahead, Ronnie.
I had a question for Katya on that exact issue.
Oh, okay.
So it strikes me that the kinds of research you do, both formative and evaluative, so much relevance to what we are looking to do with youth and financial services, grow the market, change behavior. I think one of the nice parts about the project is we have a way to sort of do formative research, but then also track the reality of it, because there's what people say they want or they do, mm-hmm. and then there's what they really want or they do, and I would think even more so with reproductive behaviors. How do you track that, and mm-hmm. how do you sort of track the differences?
Sure, and that's a really good question, because we're often faced with that in healthcare, where you're like, are you using a condom? And they're like, oh, absolutely, every time. And you see them 2 weeks later at the clinic, and they're like, I missed my period. And you're like, right, of course. A lot of times, we do a lot of data triangulation. So what, and with qualitative data, it's with quantitative data, it can kind of be a bit tricky. So a lot of times what I'll do is I'll hold a focus group discussion, and I will have the group kind of talk about, you know, for example, wearing condoms, negotiating condoms, and then I'll present to them the results from the survey. And oftentimes it will conflict with what they're just told me. I'd be like, yes, but the survey among your peers says this. And a lot of times that's when you can get the really rich information out of them. You know, it's be like, well, I didn't wear it in this instance. My rent was coming up, you know, my sugar daddy said he'd give me an extra $5 if we didn't wear a condom, and that's where that comes up. So sometimes presenting that survey data in a focus group discussion to actually get them to justify, it's like, you know, the two different findings, and it can be a very, very rich experience, needless to say. But it can be very hard, especially with the savings, and to actually see what they're doing at the end of the day.
Yes, definitely. I mean, there are also methodological experiments to try and interview people in different ways instead of face-to-face verbal interviews. It's, you know, having them answer questions using a little, like, pin pad and not have to face a human being to answer the question. So there's work going on around that in terms of more accurately self-reporting.
We give them, like, little sexual diaries, mm-hmm, and they can, you know, talk about that, and then at the end of the day, you know, they'll share them with us. Everything's anonymous, but that's also a really interesting way to track their thoughts and then track their behaviors side by side.
So I think we're out of time on this panel, and I just want to thank the panelists for doing a great job, and also for the participation from the audience as well.
Okay, you can stretch. That's all. Welcome to panel two, where we're going to be focusing on nudging behavior and savings. I'm Reed Kramer. I direct the asset building program here at the New America Foundation. And I'm also a member of the steering committee of the YouthSave project. So really, it's a pleasure to have everybody here, the panelists and those in the room and our funder, and I really appreciate your work and efforts on this project. So neoclassical economics tells us that individuals will rationally choose to maximize their utility subject to constraints. That's the theory. It's taught all over the world. But we know in the real world, it works very differently. And in the last 10 years or so, I'd say, there's been a lot of interest in the rise of this field of behavioral economics, which is really a body of work that focuses on, you know, how people make decisions in the real world. And it's a very relevant body of work that's gained a lot of attention among policymakers and people that design programs that are very interested in achieving certain outcomes, maximizing outcomes. And I think one of the robust findings from this work has been that the economic decisions that people make are strongly influenced often by the result of a no decision, by doing nothing, the default. And we've learned in a lot of different settings that the default can be pretty powerful. Inertia is a pretty powerful force. We've also been learning a great deal about ways to kind of nudge people along, move them along into better outcomes. So that's what this panel is going to look at. It's going to look at different ways that we can nudge youth along in managing their money and their finances, and hopefully increase their financial capability. So we have four presentations. The bios are all in the handouts. People are going to come up one by one. There will also be PowerPoints. Then we'll all get together at the table and have an extended discussion. So first we're going to hear from Jamie Zimmerman, who directs our Global Assets Project, who welcomed us here today. She'll start us off. Then Matt Despard is a clinical associate professor at the School of Social Work at the University of North Carolina at Chapel Hill. Julie Lee is with us. She's a training officer at Microfinance Opportunities. And then Alexander Fiorillo is from Ideas 42. She's vice president there, and we'll hear from her as well. So let me get out of the way. Jamie.
Okay, hi. Just a couple things before I get started that I just want to throw in while I have the podium and the ability. The first, so I think I'm the only person here today that's not doing a PowerPoint presentation, so you're just going to have to listen and look at me. Sorry, so bear with me on that. But I also wanted to point out a recent edition of the Washington Monthly, which is bi-monthly publication that is just always full of some really great content for those of you not familiar with it. The most recent edition it's actually focused on asset building and success and of Americans, of citizens in America, but it's actually, I think, something that'd be really relevant to everybody here in the room. But wanted to point out that there's one opening kind of article, I won't even call it really an article, opinion piece at the beginning of this edition that is titled, Where Are the Women Wonks? And there is, and I thought about this as I was looking at the last panel and the makeup of our day, and it says very clearly in this opinion piece that you walk into the run-of-the-mill DC think tank and what you see is a panel of gray hair, testosterone in suits. And so I just want to say to Reed and to Matt, welcome to the new minority. This is not the not the way of the future. So I would like to just, you know, maybe point that out to whoever that author was, that maybe she might have gotten a couple things wrong. So I know I'm eating into my time, so I, you know, won't dwell on that any further, and I, you know, stickler on the time thing. So also just wanted to point out that I am I'm here today to present some a new paper that we're releasing today called Creatures of Habit, Nudging Savings in Youth. The author of this paper, Payal Pathak, was with us for with us here at the New America Foundation and within the Youth Save Initiative for a number of years, but just, you know, recently moved on. Now she's doing some really exciting field work in India and China and couldn't be here to present today. So I'm going to present on her behalf, and I hope I do her justice, but I just want everyone to know that this is her brilliant thinking and not not my work alone. So just wanted to also throw that out there. So, you know, we've already heard, I think, a lot about the potential benefits to youth, financial markets, even whole economies, of being financially included and having financially responsible youth. And clearly, to me, the promise of the power of asset effects, the economic, social, civic, and psychological effects that having assets has on people is enough to encourage decision makers to want to find ways to enable and accelerate the pace of enabling youth to lead productive and included lives. But the act of saving and decision making surrounding it can be quite strenuous, particularly for youth, and even more particularly for low-income youth. You know, as Reed was saying, often rational choices are not made, and there's this growing body of knowledge that tells us that nudging behaviors can potentially have a powerful impact on enabling financial capability. I think there are still many, many questions around financial capability that need to be answered. We even still are debating how to define it and what it means, and I think that that's a great debate to have. But also questions on how best to do it, what's most effective, what could have the greatest impact for whom and when. So the paper I'm presenting on today, and it's outside amongst the slew of other papers, but it's here, and I encourage everyone to grab it or get one online. The paper I'm presenting today shares some new perspectives on nudges and interventions to create very specifically sticky savings habits at an early age when behaviors are still very malleable. And this may have significant impacts over the life cycle or the developmental phases of low-income youth. Savings habits can convert what we would say is an otherwise pretty taxing mental process into an automatic, easy action through practice over a longer period of time. So in effect, practicing skills that are part and parcel of saving also, so these things like self-control, planning, future orientation, can also improve cognitive strength and livelihoods through a number of multiplier effects. We think when you add the proper support services. So in this paper, we argue that practitioners and policymakers could maximize the effects of savings habit formation in youth by A, nudging the savings as early as possible, and B, taking advantages of these developmental touch points in the life cycle of youth. So I'm going to just cover 4 points really briefly today in the panel, and then hopefully have more time for Q&A. The points are why nudging financial capability among low-income youth is important, perhaps even necessary. 2, the role of habit formation and how you successfully create habits. 3, the multiplier effects of skills developed through savings habits, especially when you start young. And 4, the importance of intervening at critical life stages. So, excuse me, 1, why do we need to nudge financial capability among youth? So, you know, as we've heard, I think, for the last hour and a half, that savings is an important contributor to individuals' well-being. It's a decision that requires the use of cognitive capabilities such as self-control, willpower, future orientation, and these mental or cognitive resources, kind of like the energy we expend in the things that we do in life, they're limited and they're drainable in the short term. So when burdened with economic choices, we deplete these resources, we use this energy, leaving less mental control to carry out other important behaviors, including limiting our spending, setting aside savings for future needs and the like. So, you know, while the more well-to-do and the rich are also taxed by economic decisions, surely, that are mentally draining and stressful, they face far less severe and regular consequences from these decisions than do the poor. Poverty is, I believe, is Sindel Mullinathan has quoted, psychologically important because it's a form of scarcity, which causes people to experience more stress, expend greater willpower than their more affluent counterparts. So saving and asset building can, I think, mitigate the scarcity, but at the same time, money itself and that act of saving is yet another economic decision that the poor will have to carefully calculate in their lives. This brings me to my second point, which is the role of habit formation and how you can create these savings habits. Fortunately, our brains are structured such that human beings don't actually need to use up all of our mental resources or cognitive thought on all actions. It turns out we are creatures of habit. We argue that one approach to creating savings habits is through establishing what some behavioral economics refer to as habit loops of cues, routines, and rewards. So I'll run through that very briefly. And so studies have shown that habits are formed often when a specific environmental cue triggers a behavioral response or a routine that often results in a reward. So one example that we use in the paper that I think maybe some of you could relate to is moviegoers who habitually eat popcorn when they go to the movies. The movie theater is the cue that triggers this behavioral routine, eating popcorn, that satisfies them in some way, which is their reward. And it tells the brain that this loop is worth remembering and repeating in the future, and they just kind of do this every time that they go, and that's how it works. An environmental cue or context may create new circumstances that bring about behavior change. For youth, the best time to create savings habits may be during these key transitional periods in their lives when new cues, such as nudges, just-in-time education, other interventions can lead to new routines and new rewards. In the context of savings, rewards can play an integral role in perpetuating habits. So small prizes, seeded accounts, match savings, or simply the satisfaction of achieving a savings goal can nudge a person into continuing their habit loop. So this leads me to my third point on how the skills underlying these savings habits can have other multiplier effects on youth livelihoods, and the earlier you start, the better, which I just think is an underscoring of, why youth, why early, why now. So when people choose to save money, they call on these certain inherent capabilities or qualities, these cognitive skills, the self-control and the planning to attain a future savings goal. And recent studies have shown that self-control and planning are two skills that, when developed very early in a person's life, have strong associated multiplier effects and can play an important role in enhancing other aspects of economic and social well-being. So therefore, the act of saving involves practicing some salient behaviors that can arguably counter the mental fatigue of economic decision-making in life, but also lead to other positive outcomes. Unfortunately, though, low-income youth are at a big disadvantage in developing these skills early on. They face a lot of economic uncertainty. They don't have adequate services. The conditions of poverty overall impose barriers to developing these skills. So we believe that there's a role to play by policymakers, donors, practitioners, in understanding and filling in that gap by creating, testing, funding interventions, depending on who you are and what your interest is, that help create these habit loops during key life cycle or trigger phases, points where behaviors of youth are most malleable and where the positive effects of interventions could be maximized. Which brings me to my last point, which is on these interventions themselves. The program and policy level interventions, when delivered at these transitional phases in the youth life cycle, can maximize the impacts of savings habit formation. So Tanaya, and I'm going to take one more minute, since I wasted that first minute. It wasn't a waste. I'm glad I said what I said. I don't take it back, but I'm I'm not getting off the podium. So just really quick. Really quickly, these interventions. So at different points of the life cycle, and we go into a lot of detail in the paper, so I won't belabor it now. But I think I was going to reference the presentation that I saw Tanaya did, where she talked at length of different life cycle phases of youth. And I think that that's really valuable. In the paper that we wrote, we take it a little bit broader. We're looking at the life cycle starting actually from birth. And the first phase that we look at is early childhood, 0 to 6. And at this age, children aren't really saving themselves, and so we're not really pushing for any sort of nudges to the children at that time. But this is a time when children can be heavily influenced by the by the decisions their parents and caregivers make. There is a really great data that came out of the SEED initiative on child development accounts, on the impact that that had on parents, and I won't go into a lot of detail about that now since I don't have a lot of time, but that these parents reported a self-perceived positive effects on self-esteem, self-efficacy, hope for the future orientation, a sense of security, fiscal prudence, and interaction with their children about finances, all really valuable things. And then later, the parents also observed the positive effects on their children, including the fiscal prudence, the future orientation, and the self-esteem. So that seems quite powerful. The second phase is middle childhood, ages 7 to 11. This is a time in life where self-control and self-regulation processes are relatively mature, and youth begin to develop an understanding of the financial world by observing and modeling their parents' behaviors. It's also a time when school teachers, peers, and so on are integral to the young people's cognitive development. But it's also, unfortunately, a time in life where many children in low-income countries are dropping out of school, the statistic is a third of children not completing primary schools, which are leaving a lot of adolescents at the margin. So this period, I think, signals a ripe opportunity for interventions that create fresh savings cues immediately when you enter the formal schooling system, and provide a stable context to maintain school attendance and savings. And then finally, the last phase is adolescence, ages 12 to 18, and this is where we focus almost predominantly all of our energy in YouthSave, 12 to 18 years old. And this is where the brain is undergoing kind of a burst of development and processing, cognitive flexibility, and goal setting. They're all relatively mature by the age of 12, although their executive processes aren't fully established. But during this time, youth are heavily influenced by their peers and engage in a lot of risky decision making, dropping out of school, abusing drugs, alcohol, practicing unsafe sex. We heard a lot about this in the last panel. So interventions that can effectively step in and cue savings routines while simultaneously improving young people's chances for productive and healthy lives by creating linkages to public health, education initiatives, and so on would be really valuable here. And there are actually some really interesting examples of some interventions that are happening right now in Malawi, Uganda, Mexico, elsewhere. I won't go into those details. So just to conclude, I think what seems critically important in all of this, just to sum it all up, and thinking about new ideas and creating habit loops, and there's a lot kind of to talk about in 8 minutes or less, but would be to think of timing and types. So timing, start young, use these life cycles, use these opportunities for intervening, and then types, considering the actual tools and rewards, those cues that you use, the rewards that are part of that habit loop, considering the specific goals at those specific times in the life cycle or whatever that development objective may be, are really powerful ways to think about, how to think creatively about the way that we could do more with this kind of new perspective and new idea. And I'll just stop there since I know that I'm over, but I'd be happy to discuss this more, provide some examples and so on during the Q&A. So thank you.
Great. Thank you, Jamie. And I'm Matt Despard. I'm glad to be here this afternoon. Jamie mentioned a gender minority. Actually, I'm a social worker, so this is very familiar territory for me. And I'm also in the gender minority at home. I have two daughters, age 6 and 14. And so I have a self-interest in this session because I'm always running these nudging experiments to get them to save. And so I'm kind of curious if there's any validity to my ideas. So I'm going to be talking about what's happening in Ghana in the YouthSave project. And I want to very quickly add that I'm only reporting what's happening there. If you like what you hear about what's happening in Ghana, by all means give credit to our Ghanaian partners, HFC Bank. If you don't like what I have to say about Ghana, then blame me because apparently I mischaracterized their efforts in my talk. On a more serious note, the YouthSave team's thoughts and prayers are with the people of Ghana this week as they mourn the loss of their president, Dr. Mills, who passed away earlier this week. Okay, so let me start with Just a question about how Ghanaian youth will be nudged to save with the bank. And so these are the plans that are drawn up to be implemented starting in September when the youth return to school. And bear in mind, everything that I have to say today is about the in-school population in Ghana. So Jamie just got done talking about different types of nudges, and I think just articulated those very nicely. So I want to relate what's happening in Ghana to some of the things that that Jamie just mentioned. The in-school banking strategy, of course, it's not new. It's happening on a very large scale in Sri Lanka through Hatton National Bank. It's actually been around as long as the late 19th century. But there's some interesting features to it in Ghana. The bank officials will be coming into the schools, making it simply easier, more accessible for youth to make deposits. Teachers will be reminding youth on a weekly basis that Friday's banking day, and so that's kind of what Jamie was talking about in terms of the environmental cue that youth will receive. And I should hasten to say that it's a salient environmental cue because teachers are respected authority figures. And so it'll be an important reminder that the youth get when it comes from a teacher. The visits will be weekly, so there's the encouragement of some habit formation. Kids get used to the opportunity to make a deposit every Friday. But by the way, when I was looking at the history of in-school banking, late 19th century, the banking days were on Monday. And so maybe we've evolved in our thinking about in-school banking that we should make banking days on Friday before kids blow all their money over the weekend. So another thought is that the just-in-time education that Jamie mentioned will happen when HFC officials come to the school not only to facilitate deposits but also to offer some low-touch financial education. And this is not going to be soup-to-nuts financial education. It's going to be really focused on saving and helping kids see the connection between saving and their longer-term goals, helping them articulate their longer-term goals, help them, and this is an important one, help them understand how to save, you know, how to set a goal for saving, and well, how much do I need to save on a weekly basis, and how do I do that without compromising meeting my basic needs? And you know, these are youth, not compromising having a little fun as well. So they're going to help the youth figure out how to save, not just why it's important. And the thing that's has really impressed me about HFC is they're very, very concerned about the nature of the interactions that bank officials will have with youth. The training will not just be, well, here's the mechanics of how you facilitate in-school banking. The training is going to be on soft skills. How do you make interactions with bank officials friendly and enjoyable for youth? So it's going to be very interesting to see how that rolls out. Oops. Okay. So looking just briefly at the experiment and the research design to answer the question, how will we know if these nudges work? There's three different treatment arms. And so we have this distinct treatment arm that allows us to look differentially just at the effects, the treatment effects, meaning the effect on actual savings of these sets of nudges as opposed to general outreach and marketing. The cluster randomized design is really important, meaning we have randomly assigned whole schools to either treatment or control conditions. And that's really important based on what Jamie just mentioned, that youth are heavily influenced by their peers. So if we didn't randomize at the school level, it would be research chaos because kids would be nudging each other. The kids in the treatment group would be nudging kids in the control group, and we don't want that because we wouldn't be able to see the differential effects. So we're pretty excited about our design. It's also important to acknowledge that with self-report survey data, there's a certain amount of measurement error. But with the randomized design, on a probability basis, we know that measurement error will be equally distributed in the treatment and control groups. But as Lisa outlined, the savings demand assessments are going to be prove really critical to triangulate some data, but also to serve as those direct observations of saving behavior. So just a few words about what we've discovered so far from our baseline survey data. And it looks very, very similar to the market research that Rani Deshpande outlined earlier. I was also really struck by how similar the findings are to what the YouthStart market research has borne out, which is another MasterCard Foundation-funded project, that generally speaking, kids are saving relatively small amounts of money, or I should say more accurately, they're setting aside this money, and it's for, they're holding it for shorter durations in for more near-term consumptive needs, school fees, personal items, and so forth. On a positive note, the youth in Ghana have told us they're really excited about banks and think interacting with banks is an okay thing. They just don't know a lot about how to go about doing it. So they seem to be predisposed to saving with the bank. And that might be related to the fact that about three quarters of them have had savings-focused financial education in the schools already. So there's already been some exposure and some predisposition, perhaps. Lastly, the thing that we are going to be looking at more closely is this finding that there's two important predictors of youth's money management behaviors that are starting to come out of the data based on our multivariate analyses, and that is parents who explain their financial decisions is an important predictor of more robust money management behaviors, and youth who have some form of earned income, fetching water, cracking stones, helping mom in the market, reselling items, and so forth, is also an important and very strong predictor of money management behaviors. Thank you.
Okay, so that'll magically. Okay, great.
So, hello, everybody. My name is Julie Lee. I'm a training officer at Microfinance Opportunities. We are a global NGO established in 2002, and our focus is understanding the financial realities of low-income households and developing consumer-based solutions to those issues. We're probably best known for our work in financial education. We established the Global Financial Education Program. It's the first international program targeting low-income households with financial literacy. Since that is my background, that's actually going to be the focus or the perspective that I'm going to come from when talking about nudging behavior. So I wanted to begin with talking about how we see financial capabilities. And we see financial capabilities as the combination of the knowledge, skills, and attitudes needed to make informed financial decisions and to be able to meet those financial goals, along with the opportunity to use or apply these knowledge, skills, and attitudes. So financial education is the process for broadening understanding of financial options and principles. The skills to be able to use these financial products and services, and the product, and to promote attitudes and behaviors that support effective use of scarce financial resources. So in this way, financial education can be seen as the foundation or the basis which with young people can foster lasting behavior change. So, for example, a reminder to save in itself may not be a way to spur action among young people if the young person doesn't have the confidence that she is able to save, or that she has the knowledge or skills to be able to develop a budget or create a savings plan. So at Microfinance Opportunities, we're looking at how financial capabilities can be increased through a variety of methods, integrating into a single strategy. This can be done through awareness raising, which sensitizes people to basic money management principles, direct training, which can provide a deeper knowledge that allows people to evaluate their options, skills to manage their resources, and increase their confidence to be able to act on these knowledge and skills. And the strategy also looks at how to reinforce these messages through other channels, ensuring that the messages are not one-off, but repeated. The strategy then looks at providing young people with the opportunity to put into practice what they have learned. And this ties directly into their access, their ability to access and use financial services. We look at how different touch points or contact points with youth can be leveraged to nudge behaviors. And these touch points can be in schools, and after school club, savings group meetings, and mobile phones, or at the bank. Microfinance Opportunities has been experimenting with different types of interventions. In the past, we've done work with adolescent girls in a program funded by the Nike Foundation, where we designed financial education to accompany specially designed savings products for adolescent girls. In this presentation, I'm going to be focusing on a more recent project in Colombia, where Microfinance Opportunities worked with Save the Children in Colombia and the YouthSave Consortium to design an SMS program campaign that delivers financial education to promote savings among youth in Colombia. The objective of the SMS messages were aimed at increasing savings behavior among youth who opened a savings account that was specially designed for them. MFO provided technical assistance to design 13 SMS messages that were delivered to the youth on a monthly basis. And these messages included practical tips on how to save and motivational messages to help youth reach their individual goals. The campaign launched earlier this year, and it's running now, so we don't have results to share. But what I wanted to do was focus on our design approach to this SMS campaign. So I'm going to talk a little bit about principles of young youth learning, motivational versus skill building, well-timed triggers, and integrating the activity to a larger strategy. Our approach to designing financial education is to integrate key principles of youth learning. And some of these may be intuitive, but I'll walk you through a few of them. The idea that financial education needs to be relevant. So in the SMS messages, we provided specific advice and based it on the market research that was conducted from Save the Children and MFO's own research on with youth. And so, for example, in the SMS messages, from the market research, we learned that youth tended to save for short-term goals only, and then once they reached that short-term goal, then they stopped saving. So we included a SMS message that encouraged them to continue saving even after they've accomplished their first goal. Okay, I see I have little time left, so I'm going to move very quickly. Experiential is giving the youth concrete, achievable activities to do and reflect on. So for example, one SMS message could be write down your expenses every day for 1 week and then look at what you can reduce.
so not all of these principles could be applied to the SMS program, but they're also equally important, such as engaging, where youth can explore ideas through questions and dialogue, cooperative environment, where youth feel like they have the opportunity to belong and connect with others in a group, and inclusive of families. Any intervention should include the parents, because the parents can understand and support the youth in changing their behaviors and meeting their goals. And related to this principle of youth learning, what we learned from our own work with youth is the importance of keeping the message simple and shareable. By this, we would be able to have the girls have youth digest and remember the messages, and it makes it easier when messages are short to be able to be repeated and shared with families and friends. And also, this sharing itself promotes the youth principle of cooperative or connecting to other people in a group. Motivational and skill building. When we were developing these SMS messages, we were looking at a behavior model set forth by Dr. B.J. Fogg at the Persuasive Tech Lab at Stanford University, where they're looking at the use of technology and behavior change. And they identified three factors that prevent people from changing their behavior. One is the lack of motivation. Two, the lack of the ability or the skills needed to perform the behavior. And three, the lack of a well-timed trigger to perform the behavior. And this trigger is basically the thing that tells us to do something now. So within the SMS project, we had a debate about whether or not we should focus the messages on being purely motivational, or whether we should impart some practical tips on how to save, which would improve their ability or their skills to be able to save. And one of the concerns that we had was if we created tips for saving, that the youth might perceive these messages like the bank telling them what to do, similar to a teacher or a parent. But on the other side, we thought that if we didn't give them any tips that addressed the know-how, we wouldn't be addressing the ability factor. So in the end, we tried to strike a balance between motivational messages and instruction. And here, the tone of the SMS messages play an important role. I'm just going to move really fast. So the idea of a well-timed trigger is thinking about when the youth are most receptive to a message and when they're most likely able to act on the message. So in this SMS program, we timed the message to be delivered on the first Friday of every month. And this was because parents are usually paid at the beginning of the month. And so since they are the source of the income that they would be saving, we chose to deliver it in the beginning of the month. And also, Saturdays was usually the time that youth would be able to have time to go and visit a bank branch and make deposits. So by sending messages on Friday, the first Friday of every month, it gave the youth time, the time to plan their visit to the bank. And then just really quickly, the idea of the SMS messages can be integrated into a larger strategy. The bank staff in the program were the ones that were the first initial contact that the kids had with the bank. So the bank staff would explain how to develop a savings plan, open a savings account, and address any questions they had with products. The involvement of the parents, we had proposed that a letter be sent to the parents along with a welcome kit for the kids when they opened the accounts, so that the parents were informed and it would create buy-in. And then the idea of linking to the bank's existing marketing or promotional strategies. The idea of if they have a website that they could devote a page or create a page specifically for youth, and it would have additional resources or activities that the kids could follow through on. This I don't have time to go over, but I can talk about it during a Q&A if there are any questions. This was another example of an intervention that we did in Mongolia.
which involved financial education clubs, field trips to the bank, and the idea of student bankers. Okay, thank you.
All right, cleaning up.
Hi, everyone. My name is Alexandra Fiorillo. I'm with an organization called Ideas 42. Magic here. It happens here first, huh? Happens right here. Let's go back one slide if we can. So Ideas 42, we're an organization, a nonprofit based in New York City. We are behavioral experts. So Sendel Molnathan, who Jamie referred to, and Eldar Shafir, who's referred to in a lot in the paper, are two of my founders, my organization's founders. So I actually think it's good to go last. I'm not doing anything. I'm going to let whoever's doing that do that. Okay. So it's actually nice to go last because I think that I'll be able to kind of bring, sort of broaden the filter a little bit and go back up to more of the framework that Jamie was starting this panel off with. Can I now? So I don't even know who I'm talking to. Who's the magician? I don't know. Okay. So Ideas 42, we're actually a sort of a newcomer to the youth savings market. Again, we are behavioral experts. My entire career has been in the microfinance industry internationally, so I bring that to the table. But we're really focused on the behavior change moment. So how can we, and I'm going to talk about two types of behavior change. One is enrollment within youth savings, and then the other is usage and continued usage. That's why I was asking the question earlier about withdrawals. But our organization, just to give you a little bit of background, we work in basically three buckets. One is educate, where we do executive education courses and really try and help popularize the non-freakonomics, more of the sort of academic research-focused behavioral economics insights, and how can we actually take insights from behavioral economics research and behavioral psychology and apply those to the field. So our organization, actually, our mission is to use behavioral economics for social good. Everything we do, we try and have some sort of social impact and also achieve scale. Scale is really important to us. We do a lot of scaling up and replication work. Our second bucket is what we call assist, more commonly probably referred to as sort of nudges, as you've heard today. So how to teach policymakers or practitioners how BE insights, behavioral economics insights, can help them improve product or policy or program design. So that's little tweaks to programs that are already in existence. Then the last bucket is our invent bucket. And that's where we're actually creating new products or new policies or new programs that are behaviorally informed and designed with a lot of these insights from behavioral economics. I'm going to touch on two field studies that really focus more on the invention side of our work, but are, I think, relevant to the conversation today around youth savings. One's a domestic project and one's international for adults, but I think we can draw a lot of interesting insights from that project. So one thing that's important to acknowledge is that we can't just sort of throw things at the wall and see what sticks. The behavioral toolkit is really large, actually much larger than probably we think of. And some approaches are actually contradictory to one another. So it's really important to know the context and know the clientele that you're working with and design nudges or interventions that are designed for the appropriate diagnosis. And I'm going to talk a little bit about what I mean when I say diagnosis today. I'll talk through the process a little bit on the next slide, actually. Let's see if I can. I'm going to do my own magic here. So let's talk about the psychology of saving. 5 minutes already, my lord. Psychology of saving. One important aspect of our approach, Ideas 42 approach, is to recognize that surface similarities between projects may actually mask substantial differences. So for instance, the two field studies I'm going to talk about both address savings and psychology of savings, but in radically different populations. And so we're going to see that the treatments are different as well based on the kinds of populations that they're addressing. We have a process that's called behavioral mapping, and this is a process that leads us to a set of hypotheses related to the psychological bottlenecks that might be at play preventing whatever outcome that you're trying to achieve. So what's your objective outcome? Why are we not achieving it? What are some of the psychologies that might be at play preventing you from achieving that outcome? We haven't actually done extensive field work in this youth savings area, but a first approach might be to separate enrollment and usage. So I'm going to go ahead and just jump to that, and we can come back to this if we need to later on. And in the interest of time, I will just highlight that there are sort of four types of interventions. This is a little bit technical for today, but we can certainly talk about it during Q&A. I'll try and be mysterious and not say too much about it. The first is debiasing the person. The second is debiasing the context. The third option for intervention is rebiasing the person, so actually enforcing a bias that previously exists. Sorry, the fourth is reinforcing biases, which is actually trying to perpetuate a bias that already exists. And we can talk about, this is sort of to Reed's comment about the defaults, we're using here an enrollment of a product as an example, and you can see how each of those might relate to different types of interventions. Okay, so let's get into savings accounts. Let's talk about enrollment. So getting youth to enroll in savings accounts requires a few things. There's the decision to do so, and then there's actually the action. And I just want to unpack the decision, so the intention to enroll. If people already want to save money, that's fabulous, right? You've already gotten over that sort of intention hurdle. So we can move straight on to the action. But the population may not have the intention to save. So this is an example of where the behavioral mapping has to be very context specific. And if not, if the population doesn't want to save or doesn't have the intention to save, you have to actually create that intention for them or help them create that intention. And you can do this in two ways. You can create the intention to save in the context if the diagnosis that people feel like saving isn't for me or I'm not someone who saves or savings isn't important for my lifestyle. You could actually use social norms or identity formation to help create the feeling like, oh, other people are saving in my community. In the school that Matt talked about, you know, my peers are saving. There's other students that are saving. That feels like something that I could do as well. So creating some sort of identity formation. Or if people are really underweighting the future benefits of the savings that they might accumulate, then you can offer an immediate prize. So create some immediate saliency of what that savings account might be. And this was talked about earlier today as well. But now you also have to consider people who have the intention to save, that want to save, but who don't take the action for some reason. And Reed was talking about this, so the failure to decide what happens in that situation. So we might see limited self-control or prospective memory, which Jamie referred to earlier. So people may simply forget or not have the self-control. So you can use messaging to actually remind people to sign up. Or it could be that there's a hassle related to savings. So small changes to make people's lives easier can actually have a really big impact in how they enroll and take up savings accounts. You can also offer implementation assistance for anyone who's familiar with Phil Oriopoulos' work on FAFSA, form enrollment, something like that. So actually helping them to complete the enrollment forms or to complete the process of enrollment. So thinking about the future and making savings calculations can be more difficult at certain times. And this gets to the trigger work that Julie was just talking about. So actually creating timely triggers that are matched up to the cycle of the savings behavior. Just a couple of ideas on the use of savings accounts. So once you've got people enrolled, then how are they going to actually use it and continue to use it? Again, identity and norms can be a factor in the decision to actually save. Even if you have an account, you need to re-decide every time you're going to actively put money into that savings account. So every time you get a paycheck, you actually have to make the decision and then take the action, yes, I want to save again. So showing people an implementation plan that they drew up previously, so I made a commitment to save, reminding them of that commitment that they made when they enrolled in the program might be a way to make the prospect of savings less daunting and remind them that they decided back then that they wanted to be a saver, so really making that identity salient. Reminding people of their early decisions to save can also make people more likely to decide the same way again and again, so repetition of behavior, since people really like being consistent, which goes to Jamie's point of habit formation. And finally, you can remove the decision to make that savings commitment every single time by making the savings decision automatic, so by direct deposit or other means. I'm going to save the rest in case there are other questions about the psychologies at play. I just want to share two quick examples. So the first, this is actually a study in Malawi. It was farmers, tobacco farmers. These are adults, so not youth, but again, I think it's relevant. So these tobacco farmers in Malawi get paid at the harvest, at the time of harvest, so not before. And they often don't save to buy fertilizer or other inputs for the next harvest. So the study took farmers who didn't have savings accounts and divided them into three groups, a control group, some who were offered a direct deposit account with no commitment features, and then others who were offered direct deposit with commitment device included. It's our clever little lock and money there. The non-commitment account group had the same outcome as the control group, which is not great. But the farmers who got the commitment savings account actually spent 27% more on their inputs, and also 22% more in outputs as well. So they earned 22% more in outputs. So the commitment features put an extra 29,000 Malawian kwacha, which is about 108 USD, into the farmer's pockets, just that little part of the commitment savings device. And if you think about 108 USD in Malawi, that's actually quite significant relative to their per capita GDP. There's every reason to think that these returns would be the same or higher in future years. So this was a one-time project, but you can draw out the conclusions later on. So this was a case of impatience, limited self-control, where the farmers weren't making current decisions for their future selves, where we really needed the full power of a commitment device to see the positive outcomes. And just on the other side of that, a youth example, and then I'll be out of your hair. This was a domestic project here in D.C., actually, the Summer Youth Employment Program in Washington, D.C. This treatment was applied to these youth participants in this program, and the issue that they were facing was really enrollment. They were having uptake issues. So on the decision side, these teens might have decided to save. They might have had the intention to save. They might have had a high discount rate so that they thought it wasn't worth it to sign up. So they wanted to save, but there were other things getting their way, different psychological bottlenecks preventing them from actually taking the decision to enroll in the program and then use it. Even if these youth had decided to save, then setting up a bank account also could have been a hassle. So there are lots of potential reasons that the children, that the youth were not enrolling in the program, even though the program thought that it designed for all of these different hurdles. So once you actually did the diagnosis, they found a few different things were at play: discounting, the norms, and there was this hassle factor of actually signing up. The intervention was to send an email offering a change in payment method from a prepaid debit card to a direct deposit situation with or without automated savings deposits. There were options. And if you signed up for the automated savings, you were actually entered into a lottery to win a cash prize. So that was that immediate prize component that I mentioned earlier. So very importantly, it was easy to make an account and set up the direct deposit. It was only a few clicks. This was an electronic system. There's only a few clicks after opening the email. And the youth never had to even visit the bank. So we were really trying to reduce the hassle factors in this particular pilot. The email was also framed to eliminate the perception that prepaid cards were the default payment option, even though that they were. So it was also a framing issue. So sort of messaging and marketing is how we would call it in the field, framing in our behavioral psychology world. So we don't actually have a control group in this project, but of the 9,000 teens in the program who received the email, 1,300 signed up for direct deposit, and 800 of those were actually newly created accounts. So the numbers are quite encouraging. And of those 1,300, 78% set up automated savings. So that's a pretty remarkable number. And this is a pretty broad and low-touch intervention, so there aren't really precise takeaways necessarily. But one of the main lessons that we drew from it was that making it easy for youth to save leads to more savings. And this is maybe really obvious, but it's really important. So we can easily imagine that if there had been some more work to understand the precise psychologies that were at play of the clients, including obviously measuring with a control group and seeing what the effects would have been, a more carefully designed intervention may have even worked better and had better outcomes. So just to last slide, sort of work to be done. I'm always thinking about next steps. So we do know a few ways to get people to save. We've got some tricks up our sleeves. There's been a lot of work done in the behavioral psychology and behavioral economics field. Lots of interesting and clever interventions have been tested. But finding the most effective ways and the ones that are most specific to the youth market requires, I think, a lot of future and further evidence and research. We need to understand the bottlenecks keeping youth from saving. They're likely going to be different. The psychological barriers are likely going to be different than adults. Just different things are relevant to them. Different things are front and center in their minds, and they've got different challenges in their home lives and their school lives. A little bit more theoretically, I would just conclude by saying that most of the behavioral economics insights I've talked about are based on studies in adults, and we really need to know more about how all these psychologies will play out in younger people. But I think we do have enough to get started in terms of designing the savings products. It's just a little bit more consideration around the context and the actual individuals involved to figure out what some of the other defaults could be or ways to incentivize youth to enroll in the program. And then our concern is really continued usage. And we just would caution people to be very careful in your diagnosis. We spend a lot of time really focusing on the diagnosis of the problem. We make a lot of assumptions in our work in the microfinance industry, I know. So we'd like to spend a lot more time diagnosing what the challenges are before actually jumping to the design of the solution. So we can certainly talk through some of this in the Q&A, but just wanted to provide a little bit of a slightly different framework. Thanks so much for having us.
Great. Look forward to an extended conversation here involving all of you in the room. We'll have a roving mic around, so let me know. Let me just start by commenting how there really is a high bar to clear here when we're focusing on youth savings. Savings isn't easy for all of us. Then for some of us, the non-youth population, there might be some things in play that we can take advantage of, like our employment setting. Certainly, the way I save is a number of years ago when I started working here, I signed one form, and I was automatic, you know, I rolled in our 403B plan, and it happens automatically every 2 weeks, and maybe I've periodically revisited it with a different allocation, but essentially, not a lot of thought goes into it. That's not what we're looking at here with this population. And I guess I wanted to ask you collectively to think a little bit about this interaction between maybe the nudge and the default that might be there, and if there are ways to think more automatically about how we could introduce some features into the process, maybe from the experiences that you've observed in the field, or some of the theoretical work, how you guys approach it at Ideas 42. So kind of this trade-off maybe between the nudge and the default and ways to kind of make them align. Alexandra, maybe you'll start.
So can you guys all hear me? Is that okay? Yeah. Okay. So the way we would approach this is we try and find really creative touch points. So Reid, the way you framed it, right, was for adults, maybe the touch point or the intervention point is in the workplace. So I think there are a million ways, and I think Matt talked about one in the school. There are many creative touch points that we can use with youth, whether that's domestically we think about, you know, summer programs or after school programs. It could be a religious affiliation, a school, a church group. But I think that being creative in terms of how we're engaging different populations, knowing where they are and where they sort of flock to, a lot of the work in savings is typically assumed to be like a 401k work that you all might be familiar with. I'll follow Reid's train of thought. Tends to focus on sort of net present value, so immediate needs versus future needs. But actually thinking about some of the other psychologies at play when thinking about youth, I think are going to be a little bit more salient, like the identity norm. So we actually talk a lot about identity formation, peer group identities with youth, which is a lot more salient actually than in the adult population. So just kind of flipping the coin on its head a little bit, thinking about the population, where they congregate, what the touch points are, and then trying to leverage those sort of unique opportunities with the youth market, I think is a little bit different than how we would approach it with adults. And you can certainly create either default or nudges, frankly, in any of those creative touch points. I think there's a lot of opportunities for both. Depends what your desired outcome is.
Yeah, I'll jump in on that too, and to say, you know, I agree with everything Alexandra has just said in terms of, you know,
things that you're talking about, what the outcome is that you're, you know, wanting to achieve, and that, you know, the diagnosing that you do based on where that youth might be and what the outcome you want to see, you're going to have, you know, some variation in the way that you approach it. So, you know, there might not be replicability of, you know, all different types of interventions across all contexts, and I think that that's important. You know, I think that there are also some other interesting and exciting things that opportunities to take advantage of from the youth context that could be considered. One is, I think, the prevalence of social cash transfers in a lot of countries. This is something that you know, automatic, usually monthly, sometimes bi-monthly, sometimes bi-weekly payments. In many countries, they go to parents, but also there are child allowances and cash transfers, especially for children and youth, and some of those are detailed in our paper, where this is a regular payment of a cash transfer, typically conditioned on some sort of behavior. That could provide a really, I think, interesting opportunity. And usually that behavior is not continued saving or even the beginning of savings. But I think that you could consider leveraging it for that purpose, for financial inclusion and for asset building, with the right kinds of little moderate tweaks. I think that that's really interesting. I also think there's a lot of interesting stuff going on with gaming and texting. That, you know, we heard about the interesting texting. I think that gaming is, you know, when we're talking about very low income people and children, maybe that's not always so relevant. But, you know, I've been to many an internet cafe in a small developing country, and there's plenty of it happening. I think that that's maybe another interesting place to think about ways to do something that's a nudge that doesn't feel like it in a way. So I think that that's something else to consider.
One of the projects that we worked on with adolescent girls was in Burundi, working with CARE. And CARE set up village savings and loans groups specifically for adolescent girls. So they would put aside money each week, and within the group they decided the amount that they would save. And so once they collected the money, then they would loan it out to the other members. And so this was a good opportunity to nudge them to save. The peer pressure within the group was also important in getting them to save.
Anything in Ghana to add?
I honestly, Rita, I was a bit stumped, you know, because I got hung up on the automatic, you know, because what you mentioned about the 403B automatic enrollment, and so I think, you know, in other contexts, the institutional arrangements are maybe not as favorable. You know, you've got a high rate of informal employment. You know, a lot of cash transactions, and then it's even more irregular among youth, and it could be seasonal. But on the other hand, you know, I thought about, you know, are there ways to leverage the school settings as institutional structures? And this is pure conjecture. You know, maybe when parents and their kids are paying school fees or paying for school supplies, maybe there's an opportunity to nudge them or default them into some additional savings, perhaps for education. And it also thought of perhaps remittances as a transaction opportunity involving financial services.
And of course, what you need there, and let's open it up for some questions now. But what you need there is you need the financial provider to, you know, be open to exploring these opportunities, these leverage points, connecting to the school environment, if that's particularly promising. I'm actually carrying around some cash from my daughter that I need to deposit into her account. She has a account at SunTrust, and you actually, for this account, low cost account, you have to show up and deposit it, and that's just not how I bank anymore. So, and the hours aren't, you know, really good, and they close when I'm at home in the neighborhood. And so anyway, I gotta figure out how to do that before she gets home from camp. let's start here and then over here. Yeah. Should we grab a new mic? These are connected, actually. Let's shout it out for now, and then we'll fix it and circle back.
And how they get involved in being part of the education, you know, if they are, and how you kind of do that, and also to make sure that the student's money or the individual, you know, children's money doesn't actually end up going to the family or to the parents at some point down the road.
How do you engage with parents?
Yeah.
What happened in Ghana?
Well, I know that I can say that HFC Bank is in their partnerships with schools. They also plan to engage PTAs, my colleague David Ansong from the Center for Social Development might comment a little bit further on this. David, do you want to say anything about how HFC is looking at engaging parents through the schools through the PTAs?
Hang on. There you go. Grab it.
Hello? Yeah. So my name is David Anson from CST. So what HFC is going to do is at the beginning of the semester, the schools require teachers to come for PTA meetings. So they plan to get parents at that time to engage them, explain what we're doing to them. And some of these PTAs are held sometimes twice or three times a year. So they hope to use those opportunities to engage the parents. Sometimes, you know, for instance, we have a third cohort that we plan to engage, you know, them because they are leaving the school. So the parents will come to the schools for their results. So that's another opportunity to meet the parents and engage them, which is different from the PTA meetings. So that's what they've planned for now. They might be planning other stuff that I don't know for now.
Yeah, thank you.
And I'll just add one comment on that. There was another question about how do you make sure that the money doesn't go to the parents eventually. You know, I think that it's difficult to control that. I mean, there are ways, such as, you know, there are some commitment savings accounts where that committed savings, once that's developed and the goal is reached, or the time where the access to that money is available, it goes straight to a higher education institution, or maybe to into some sort of training, or an investment. But I think that you'd have to debate some of the pros and cons of limiting the access to the money in that way. Versus just taking the risk that at a certain age that youth, or maybe when they become an adult or when they're still a youth, that they might choose or be coerced into giving some of that money. So I think that there are ways to address that, but I don't know in every case that you'd want to. So I just wanted to note.
If I could add to that, in Mongolia it was interesting because the bank that we worked with, Haas Bank, they had developed a savings product that the girls who were 14 to 18, they could open the account on their own. So they didn't have a co-signer. So they had complete control over their money once they opened the account. So maybe that you look at product design when you're designing products for girls. If of course, the banking regulations allow that. In Mongolia, they did allow that. So it was an interesting finding.
Here.
Thank you. Ilka Funke, consultant, World Bank. I have a question regarding consumer protection. Fostering savings in youth, it's a great idea, but it can go terribly wrong when pyramid schemes and others detect that. Are you piloting also in the financial education area how to bring messages across, what to look for to prevent fraudulent behavior and ripping off the youth?
Right. So the question's on consumer protections and avoiding pitfalls.
I'm being managed by Tanaya. So Ideas 42 and CGAP actually just about a month ago, actually, a little over a month ago, held an event here in D.C., behavioral economics research and consumer protection. So it was spot on to your question. It was not tailored to the youth market, but again, I think there are a lot of really relevant lessons. I would encourage you, I mean, if Tanaya or Alexia want to say anything, I would encourage them to speak up. There's a whole blog series on the CGAP blog about behavioral research and how that will help us actually improve our consumer protection policies. And one specific component in our work on consumer protection, behaviorally informed consumer protection, is dispute and recourse, in addition to transparency. There's also a financial education piece. And then our fourth is over-indebtedness. So these are the four themes that we're looking at, the consumer protection research through a behavioral lens. There's a lot of, actually, research being done in it at the moment, and we're trying to engage more academics in the research agenda. There hasn't been a ton previously, but I think this is definitely where the industry is going in terms of interest. So definitely link up with Alexia and Tanaya or myself, and we can give you more specifics on it. But it's a growing concern and one that we want to address sooner rather than later.
Great. Yeah, let's go right here, and then we'll come to you, sir.
Hi, Katja Peterson again from PSI. I was just thinking about the whole kind of read what you were talking about, savings and walking around with money for your daughter. I have three savings accounts. One is my retirement, my 401. Then I have a savings for my AC unit that's getting close to about 24 years old, and the inspector tells me it's going to go out, so I'm saving for that. And then I have my savings, you know, for my big Paris trip in a few weeks. And
now, are you in different accounts? Obviously, your retirement is in one, but then there's two separate other accounts.
Two separate accounts.
Okay, you've mental accounting with
you got it. You got
an
it.
Account.
And the
okay.
reason I do that is because my retirement is more out of fear. Why I put in there. And my Paris one is more out of gluttony. I want to drink and wine and dine and shop. And then for my HVAC is also, you know, definitely a lot of fear because then I won't have a renter. So to go to the psychology of the whole like nudging, I guess what I'm getting to is depending on what you're saving for is going to be whether you need a carrot or a stick.
Right.
And that's why I'm getting to have you. Are you really looking at this in your markets, asking these young people, you know, what are you really, really saving for? You know, if it's too long term out, I'm a perfect example of that retirement. You know, if it didn't come out of my paycheck every month, I wouldn't put in for it. My Paris trip, every other day I'm making some kind of deposit. So I'd just love to get your thoughts more on how you would address that.
Yeah, let's hear about that broadly and then maybe in the YouthSave context too, how that's being handled.
To the youth population, but broadly. So there's sort of two things that I would respond to. So first of all, you're kind of like a behavioral researcher's dream because that's a great example of very targeted savings. It's really good. So aspirational savings is actually a really strong component of the behavioral research. So people are more likely to save for something tangible and fixed than some vague pot of money that they might draw on at some point. So you're actually a really good case study in the former. So there's two psychologies that are at play that I would just highlight. There are many, but there's just two I would highlight. So one is, again, that identity formation. So if you can create the motivation and the intention to save by giving the youth or the population something specific for them to think about when they're doing so. So I want to go on vacation, so I'm going to save for this Paris trip very concretely. The other is the issue of loss aversion or gain. So there's a whole body of research within the behavioral psychology world that people actually respond a little bit more to losing something than gaining something. So the fear that your HVAC is going to break and you're going to not have air conditioning, that's probably a much more salient reason to save than saving for something positive and dreamy. Now, in the youth market, it actually might be different because what Ronnie showed, I think it was Ronnie's slide, that one of the primary reasons people were saving was for discretionary funds. Was that Ronnie's presentation? Yes. So sort of fun things. So with the youth market, probably more research is needed because they might be motivated more by the gains than the losses. But as an adult, when you've got a whole family that you're worrying about and you are more, you're wearing more your mom hat or your household hat, the loss aversion piece might be stronger. So these are just some ways to think about the psychological components.
Is there a YouthSave answer?
Well, I think just one comment is that it's something, you're naming something I think that we struggle with in working with HFC. You know, what are the messages that go into the low-touch, just-in-time financial education that happens 15 to 30 minutes before deposits start being collected? And I think we struggle with it because the short and long-term goal distinction is a tricky one, because it may be more relevant for youth to think about saving perhaps just to sustain their education from junior high school into senior high school. That might be a pretty good outcome. I think the danger is in framing savings around you can go to college, you can start a business. If that's the exclusive frame and the exclusive message, because I don't know how helpful that is. Mm-hmm. For all youth,
and certainly in the U.S. context, the saving for education for youth saving is very, you know, dominant and prevalent.
Can I add one thing? Just a quick insight that I think is just interesting. So, a year and a half, 2 years ago, we had a convening of our partners and financial institutions that we work with on YouthSave down in Colombia, and we did this really interesting group work where we broke up into groups and we tried to come up with skits and other types of marketing materials and campaigns for what we think would resonate with youth. And we had a panel of youth that were part of this intervention, I believe part of it or related to it in some way, who were kind of judging these different groups. And the skit that resonated most with these youth by far was this kind of very romantic depiction of dream it and you can be it, sort of, you know, like what you're going to achieve and the awesome things you're going to do with your life. And they just ate that up more so than I really need to buy this new Xbox or, you know, like, and that was, I think it was part of it was presentation, but I think also the message was really powerful and their response to it was just really enlightening. So I think that there's a lot that we have to learn about, you know, what resonates. I think that you're absolutely right that you know that we still need to know a lot, that there's a lot that we still don't know, I guess, about youth. But that really stood out to me.
They weren't saving for air conditioners.
Sorry, 2 seconds. So one thing I would look at, Katya, if you're interested in that your question and then also what Jamie was talking about, gamification, Piggy Mojo or Hello Wallet are two new phone apps that help people create these very salient savings goals and motivations. So two kind of fun gamification type apps that domestically are at least in play.
Okay, we have a problem. We're actually out of time and we have more questions. So my proposed solution is we keep the conversation going after closing remarks, because we're gonna be having some drinks and there's time to stick around. So please save your questions and you guys will be around and we can keep the conversation going. So let's do it that way, and then you can help me thank the panelists for their contributions today. And you guys can all exit stage right, and I'm going to stay up here and introduce Alexia Latortue, who will be offering some closing remarks on the shifting perspectives prevalent in this work. Alexia is the deputy CEO of CGAP, who you've heard a little bit about because they're a partner in the YouthSave Consortium, but they're a global independent policy and research center that really is dedicated to advancing financial access to finances for the world's poor. They've been doing a lot of expanding work we heard a little bit about on their clients and product side. And she also leads CGAP's work and outreach in sub-Sahara Africa. So they've been a great partner, a lot of great work going on there. For years, she ran the Paris office of CGAP, but recently has moved back to DC. We're pleased to have her back here, and really a long career in 15 years in access to finance issues. Previously, she worked for Development Alternatives, Inc. in both Haiti and in Washington, DC. And she does have a master's in development economics from the Fletcher School of Law and Diplomacy. Excellent institution. So, Alexia, why don't you come up here and offer some closing remarks for us today?
Great.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thanks a lot, Reed. So Ruth, are you still here?
No,
I'd love to meet your son, though. So the world belongs to me now. What an ambitious statement, a good dose of aspiration, and quite a bit of audacity in it as well. And I think, you know, at the highest level, we really are talking about Ruth's son, and the world belongs to me now. And I think the question that we're facing is, what world are we going to give to Ruth's son or to Sarah? And I think the real answer is, it depends, to be honest. And I think if we're looking at countries that are experiencing a youth bulge, it really depends. It depends on how we manage some of the transitions that we've been speaking about. And if we manage them well, we can see, hopefully, a demographic dividend. We can see increased economic opportunities and growth following these sort of youth bulge in many countries, especially in sub-Saharan Africa and in the Middle East as well. But if we don't manage the transitions well, there could be disaster, frustration, social upheaval. Unemployment is already highest among the youth today, but that even increasing. So that's what we're trying to do, I think, with the YouthSave Consortium and with the discussion we're having today around youth financial services. Now, I'd love to focus a bit more on sort of the client side of it, but I can't. The other panelists did it all day. I'm actually going to focus a bit more on the financial service provider perspective and the policymaking perspective for thinking about offering financial services to youth. But before I do that, I can't help myself, since we took a client-centered approach to this session today. I want to hear a little bit from all of you in this room and about your experiences with financial services. So I'm going to ask you to raise your hands as I ask different questions, and apologies to folks on the webinar that I can't see. So who in this room at birth basically got a savings account? Okay, so a small number of people. Who, by the time they were teenagers, had a savings account? Okay, a lot more. And who, when you were a teenager, you had a savings account, were you able to do your own transactions? Okay, great. So I think, again, I don't know the nationalities of everybody here in this room. I assume we have many Americans and probably a smattering of other nationalities. And I don't know where you grew up, but I think it's very telling to see what's happening in this room. So very few people at birth. But if you get to look at countries like the Netherlands, it would be completely different. It would be almost everybody in the room would have said yes. And quite a high number as teenagers, including people who actually had control over the accounts, which I think is very exciting. And the answers would not be the same in most emerging markets that we would go to. So now I really want to focus a bit on, you know, given that in many parts of the world the answers would have been different, what is the potential policy case for youth savings? And I mean, the youth are obviously a really important demographic group for reasons that have been mentioned before. And I'd like to posit that there are at least three really great opportunities on the policymaking side. The first one has been mentioned a lot already by Jamie and others, which is the asset building theory. Michael Sheridan, who's part of the YouthSave Consortium, his colleague Lee is in the back, did a lot of work around asset building theory and the asset effect that is both a material effect. So if you build assets, that is a good thing in terms of better access to education, to health care, to improved housing standards, but also behavioral effects, which Alex and others touched upon, the better cognitive skills, the future orientation. So policymaking case for asset building, very important. The second one that I would describe is around good financial habits. So very early on, building good financial habits. And I think all of us, even the ones that are no longer such kids in the room, know that what we start to do early in life, we tend to have a rapid uptake. We tend to remember it. The practice that also Alex mentioned being very important. The third aspect from a policymaking perspective that I think makes youth savings important is the fact that many countries actually have an explicit objective to increase their growth savings rate. And the U.S. is one country where that's not doing so well on this front. But it's important both from a household perspective, so the household having more savings to be able to deal with vulnerabilities, to be able to manage shocks that life will bring, but also at the macro national level, having capital for investment is very important.
But there are challenges, and these have come up actually through the questions and answers period. So first of all, the issue of legal age to enter into a contract. So in most countries, you become a major at 16 or 18 or even 21 in some countries, and you need to be of that legal age to open a formal relationship with a formal financial institution. And I think here, what's I think exciting is we're seeing some differentiation now between the opening of the contract, the ownership of the contract of the bank account, and the transacting. And we're seeing different regulators around the world trying to build in flexibility to allow minors to enter into contracts. So even if, for example, they have to have an adult with them to open the account, they might be able to transact on their own, especially when it comes to depositing. Even though for withdrawals, they might need to have the adult with them, but maybe the adult will not be able to withdraw alone if the minor is not there. So I think there is exciting things happening on that front. And there was a question asked about consumer protection. I think we have to remember, however strongly we want to advocate for youth savings, that there are real consumer protection reasons for having legal age of contracts. And I think we shouldn't forget that. The second sort of question mark out there, and this came up also around the policymaking side, is the documentation needed to open savings account. I mean, the good news is that around the world, when we speak about financial inclusion, there are exciting things happening in terms of relaxing documentation requirements as appropriate. So for example, the Financial Action Task Force, a standard-setting body that deals with Know Your Customer regulations, for example, has explicitly said we need to have tiered Know Your Customer regulations. So if you're talking about very small account balances, we should be able to allow less stringent, have less stringent regulations. And so school IDs was mentioned as one example of relaxing the documentation requirements. So these were sort of three positive things on the policymaking side, two question mark concerns outstanding. I'm going to very quickly now move to the financial service providers. Anne had asked, you know, more questions about the financial service provider perspective. And here I think there's a lot of opportunities out there for financial service providers to be interested in offering savings accounts to the young. I think the most powerful one is this idea of building a loyal lifetime customer base. If you acquire a person early in their lives into your financial institution, if you serve them well and meet their evolving needs over time, likelihood is that you'll keep them. And there was a study done in six European countries, including France and Germany, that actually showed that 85% of people never changed their bank in their lifetime. So good developed country experience there. And I think, Lisa, you mentioned cross-selling when you were talking and the importance of that. So the idea is that if you acquire a client young with savings, over the years, you can cross-sell different products to them and make them very attractive, even if they're not attractive on a product base. As a client, a total client value, they could be quite attractive. The second positive point from a financial service provider perspective is the idea that youth have networks that are very important. So if you get the youth in, they're often early adopters of new things, including technology, including perhaps formal financial services. So if you get them in early, you might be able to get their parents into your bank down the road, their friends into the bank down the road, which would also reduce your cost of acquiring new clients. A third positive point with regard to financial service providers, and those of you who come from the microfinance side will know that we have seen some saturation in some markets like Bosnia, like Nicaragua, like India, around very specific client segments and around very specific products. So increasingly, we're seeing some providers saying, I want to and I need to expand my market share, and I can't do it by still targeting that one type of clientele. I need to develop new client segments. And so in those countries that are facing competitive pressures, the youth client segment could be a quite exciting market to go after. And finally, and frankly, not to be, I think, neglected, is this concept of brand and building an image for strong corporate social responsibility. That can be a way for commercial institutions to, down the line, look at a client segment seriously. It starts as social responsibility, but could evolve. And I only have 2 points on sort of the real thorny issues that financial service providers face, but they're really important ones, and both of my points have the word profitability in them with a question mark. So the short-term profitability for the financial service provider to offer savings account to youth is uncertain. I think we just have to be very clear about that. And it's one of the reasons I actually wanted to start with the public policy case, because I think it's also important to remember the case may be a public policy case. And the reasons are obvious. Small balance accounts in of themselves, forget just youth, are costly and often not profitable on a product, standalone product basis. Although again, from a client, total client value perspective, may be profitable. And so there are real challenges there. Lisa, again, showed the data from at least the four pilots that were not really so far. It's early days, but so far, mostly looking at in-school youth. So if you're talking about getting to out-of-school youth, which I think we would want to, low-income youth, that's going to drive the costs up most likely. So that's a real challenge. And unfortunately, my second point, the long-term profitability is unclear as well. We know that many boards across all kinds of institutions are conservative, and they want to know up front, when am I going to break even on this, and when am I going to start making profits on this? However, we also know that boards with vision, I think about things somewhat differently, and in a lot of the conversations that we've had with the 15 or so financial service providers that are mentioned in a paper that's outside when we get to your drinks, you'll see that often they have a strategic vision to go for the youth market and to go to this market with savings products. They have a strategic long-term vision. They frankly don't necessarily do the math right away. They eventually will always do the math. So eventually we've got to crack this profitability nut. Technology could be a real piece of it in terms of sort of reducing transaction costs and reducing the costs of acquiring clients and staying in touch with them. But I do think some of the discussion needs to be reframed from the immediate business case to really understand strategically why would a smart commercial financial institution care about this this client segment. Now, the cocktail will be yours soon, my friends, but I do want to leave you with a couple of areas. I'm a bit like Alex, I like next steps, that I think requires more thought, more energy, more study. And I think this is really important because I am seeing in certain circles, to be very frank with you, this almost advocacy fervor for youth savings. And although I have an inner advocate for youth savings, I also am careful because I know from the microfinance world what backlash can mean if you overstate things without the evidence base. So food for thought in terms of areas that require more investigation and reflection. The first piece is really better understanding and getting more data on the social impact of having youth access saving services. Intuitively, it makes so much sense to me. I spent a lot of my time in Europe growing up, and it just makes so much sense. But we need the data, and we need the data from developing countries, not just developed countries. I think we also need to better understand at the national level how different parts of government can work together to really try and create smart incentives to get youth to save. So it's not just the Ministry of Finance, it could be the Ministry of Youth, the Ministry of Sports. There are really many different parts of government, often at the national level, interested in youth. And so how do they come together to create the right set of incentives, I think is really important. Thirdly, I think we need more innovation, more experimentation on the provider side. I think we need to understand what is different about serving youth. Is it the product design? Is it the marketing channel? Is it the marketing itself? Is it financial capability? Probably a little bit of all of the above, but we need to better understand these different pieces and what's important, what needs to be different, and how they interplay with each other. We do eventually have to get the numbers in terms of the profit and business case. We have to be able to figure this out down the line. And my final word will be to really, again, if we think about the world and where we're trying to go, complex lives that these youth face, often intertwining, as Tanaya said, all three transitions at once. And so I think we need to really think of the set of interventions that respond to their needs holistically. And I think holistically, both in terms of the financial services, we're talking about savings here, which is a critical saving a product, but probably they need a range of different financial services, and they also need non-financial services. So understanding that full set of interventions that youth will need, while each of us in the different roles that we place, also I think staying focused in terms of the areas of expertise that we bring to the table to then meet client needs is what I think is ahead of us. So with those few words, I have the honor of, on behalf of New America Foundation, to invite you to drinks and continued conversation right outside. Thank you very much for your attention.